Bureau, Portland Fire and Rescue, and the Bureau of Emergency Communications. First up is the Portland Police Bureau, and the floor is yours until 10:45.
Okay, good morning. Thank you. I think I'll just dive right into it. Even though I could see sunshine out the window, that's going to be a distracting pull for me today. Mayor, Commissioners, thank you for this opportunity today. I can't tell if this is too loud or not, so if it gets too loud, let me know. I can kind of back up. Okay. So with the hour and 15 minutes for our budget, I'm just going to dive right into it. But first, I want to thank the members of the community for taking time to be here. It's a big ask, and our budget is complex. So I just want to thank you for your time being here today. I do truly appreciate that. And I also want to thank CBO for their efforts. We have a good partnership in my fiscal services unit. I think we've put together a good budget presentation for you today. Hopefully this is conversational, much like the Gator sessions, which I've grown to really enjoy quite a bit. And I think instead of a one-way, I'm looking forward to the two-way dialogue. But our requested budget this year represents, overarchingly, a continuing rebuilding of our efforts at the Portland Police Bureau. We continue to focus and still will always focus on providing most of the core services that we can to the community and to support community policing in Portland. And I'm beginning the process, actually, of having an RFP developed for an overall strategic plan for the Police Bureau, because currently we do not have one. And I think it's crucial to have a strategic plan for the Police Bureau, and I want to tie that strategic plan into the city's facilities plan, because I think they should be woven quite nicely together, as well as, because I know the mayor values city-county collaboration, I do as well, to hopefully tie that plan into the county's plan where appropriate, to realize some efficiencies in the public safety sector. So now, excuse me, I'm going to address some significant issues that relate to our budgetary needs. So first, I'd be remiss if I didn't talk about Department of Justice. It seems like I'm continuing to have that as a topic. So I want council and the community to know that even though there's obviously some uncertainty right now at the federal level and where those agreements might be going, as I stated when I was the captain overseeing the Department of Justice agreement, at some point in time, the Department of Justice will leave the city of Portland. When that does occur, all our efforts for community policing, accountability, data capturing, internal legitimacy, those will stay. However we end up changing our business practices for the city of Portland to the positive, those will continue regardless of whatever uncertainty there is right now at the federal government level. So per the Department of Justice, though, 96% of our action items assigned to the Portland Police Bureau are either rated as completed or actively in progress. So we are making strides forward. And again, once they do leave, that's going to be our new business operating model for the city, for the Police Bureau. Our goal is to best serve the public with enhanced accountability and transparency efforts. And just yesterday, it's not ready for public launching yet, there's an interactive open data dashboard. So I was manipulating that yesterday, so soon the public can get onto our website and kind of create their own dashboards and see topics of interest, areas of interest in their town, and it's very, very much user interactive. Data can be kind of dry. I like it, but it can be kind of dense. This is more narrative, and that's a good thing, and again, that's towards transparency issues for the community. Another issue, a big issue, and it's my number one goal for the Police Bureau is community policing efforts in the city. A big question I think is still unanswered across the country, as well as the city of Portland, is what should community policing and engagement entail? Easy question. I think that's an excruciatingly difficult question to answer. But I think if we answer it correctly, and it's going to be iterative changes over time, we will be a leading police agency in the United States. We could have exemplary crime-fighting efforts, but if we lose the community, I believe, bluntly, our crime-fighting efforts are for naught. Right? You have to have that community engagement first. And I think when you do, you will solve some of your crime-fighting efforts, because they'll go hand in hand. But how is this going to be successful? How do we know if it's going to be successful? We are currently developing a community engagement plan and data capturing. Both those have to be tied hand in hand to make community policing efforts work. Also, since I became chief, we have now tied our annual performance evaluations for our members. There is a community engagement component in that, and as well as you are trying to get promoted in the police bureau, community engagement is part of your evaluation process. We value it that highly that if you don't get community engagement efforts right and show that you're doing something, your score for promotions is going to be lower. We are working in our engagement unit. We're starting to build an actual unit. Council, I believe, is aware of our efforts with immigrant and refugee communities. We are in the process of going through the hiring process to hire a civilian member to work on engagement efforts, specifically initially for the pilot project focusing on a Somali community. That's just a pilot. We hope to expand that over time to other immigrant and refugee communities. We also coordinate our work with neighborhood and business communities because, not to be trite, but we're all in this together. We can't leave out any certain group as we work with community because there's a lot of concerns for public safety in Portland. And we're also working on communication strategies. I think the police bureau does actually very well with one-way communication out. We're not as good with getting feedback back from the public, and we're actually poor at closing that loop. So I'm trying to work with some private sector companies on how to have dialogues through IT systems to have virtual communications with businesses and the communities. So our patrol levels, as you all know from last year's Gator sessions, which I again like very much and think were very beneficial, our patrol levels are very, very low, and our demands for service from July of 2016 forward is high. So due to that, we had discussions last year where I pulled essentially 25% of the available officers and specialty units, so not your patrol officers, but the gang enforcement team, some detectives, those other non-patrol functions, critical functions, but not answering 911 calls directly. I pulled 25% of the personnel from them to go work the street. Tough decisions, but I think it was the right decision. So due to that, we were able to have foot patrols now at all three precincts when time and staffing allows. The community feedback on those foot patrols is extremely positive. We have staffed an unsheltered outreach unit at Central Precinct for the vulnerable population on the streets, which I think everybody's aware of.
Chief, could I interrupt you for a moment? Could you give us some sense during your presentation? It doesn't have to be now. We're obviously in broad agreement around foot patrols and community policing. Could you give us some sense of how your proposed budget specifically enhances that? It doesn't have to be now. If it's later in your presentation, that's
sure. Oh, we'll do. Yeah, thank you. So unsheltered outreach unit, that helps that vulnerable population with the services they might need, connecting them to services, working with businesses, and trying to work with the county and the joint office over there to help that clientele. We have a bicycle unit downtown. We have four officers in the day and two in the evening shift. And again, that's like a walking beat on wheels, essentially, right? Doing the same type of function. Our central NERT team, and I have the sergeant for the central NERT here today, they are dedicated to coordinating the services for the housing and homeless. There's a great partnership between public safety officers who, I would say more often than not, are the first responders to folks in crisis. And though law enforcement might not be the key solution to the problem, I think we're a great connector service to the right folks who can assist in these folks who are in crisis, whether it's housing, mental illness, whatever their issues may be. It's all part of the community engagement portion. We're also working on zombie houses and derelict RVs and many, many other livability issues in the city. There's a few. But unfortunately, we have limited officer availability to attend community meetings and form relationships and assist with these efforts. So it's a little bit of give and take. It's a limited amount of resources for a large problem. So we try to best address those issues where we can as efficiently as we can. So again, with that 25% of the officers pulled from the specialty units to work the street, now, conversely, 25% less of that work's being done, right? That's just a negative trade-off from that. Council talked a little while ago about the graffiti officer program and support for ONI. We don't have that anymore. When I was at Central Precinct, I oversaw the unit that had two graffiti officers there. I talked to Commissioner Fish about this. Maybe not to everybody, but the cases that, that those officers investigated for graffiti, actually quite fascinating, and the damage to the city is a high dollar figure. But the give and take, you know, unfortunately, our resources now, we don't investigate all person crimes. So it's that, you know, robbing Peter to pay Paul, which do you do? I would love to do all of it, frankly. So I'm very much in favor of having a graffiti detail, but at the expense of what other effort won't we do.
May I ask, what is currently being done? We have an outbreak of anti-Semitic graffiti in Southeast Portland last week. I assume somebody is still investigating that, or am I incorrect about that?
No, you are correct. We are investigating it. So we have bias crime detectives that will investigate those cases.
So how are the officers then different from those individuals? Could you just give us a little more information on that?
Sure. So the graffiti, basically the hate crime, we still investigate the hate crimes as compared to if somebody's just tagging freeway overpass signs as an example. Okay. Thousands of dollars worth of damage might not be a hate crime, might not be targeted towards any one community. It's just spraying their own name or whatever. We used to investigate those, and those are felony level crimes once you aggregate those. And people actually serve prison sentences for that and became that egregious. That's the portion we're not doing. The hate crime portion we still are, and detectives do that.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you.
That topic, either now or later, could the City Budget Office help my memory? I thought that in previous years we specifically added funding for graffiti officers. So the question is, are there enough people doing the rest of the work rather than please give us more money for the graffiti team?
So when I was overseeing that unit, the Police Bureau provided one officer, and at the time ONI funded the second officer. And I'm not up to speed on ONI's budget from that point forward.
I don't think that's correct. I think that, and again, if the City Budget Office could check for us, please, because as long, you know, back in 2009, funding for the officer was not in ONI's budget. So I'd just like to know that later. Thank you.
Okay. We'll make a note of that, and we'll get back to you. So continuing on with the long-term staffing issues, another significant issue. The core police, the follow-up work, unfortunately, isn't being done. It hasn't been done for a long time at the misdemeanor crime level. So officers on the street, expectation is they will follow up on misdemeanor crime levels. That is a core service that hasn't been addressed for quite a while due to staffing issues. But conversely, the criminal calls are up 31%, livability type social disorder calls are up 23%, and due to that, self-initiated activities down about 12. Again, that's just a direct issue with staffing numbers. You know, I'm trying to implement the 21st century policing principles, right? Because I think that's the direction that this agency should go. We are doing that. But the time spent with officers and youth, as an example, is diminished a bit due to you have multiple priorities and you can only handle a few at a time. So do you do all of them marginally, or do you scoop some out and do the remaining well? I mean, it's always a little bit of a give and take. We have a long-term commitment, as council knows, to hire officers at a pace greater than attrition. So I said before at the Gator session, we have about 385 officers in the next 5 years that we're expecting to retire. So to match the attrition rate, we have to hire about 75 officers a year, which our personnel division hasn't done in the last decade or so. We've revamped that system quite extensively, and I think we've hired since the fiscal year this year about 45 or so officers, right? And 15 retiree hires, so we have about 60. So that initial realignment of how to hire officers initially is very, very promising. But again, we need to hit 75 just to keep up with attrition, not to expand, I believe, the number that we have.
Chief.
Yes, sir.
Last year in labor negotiations, there was a substantial pay increase that was offered by the city to officers in the police bureau with the expectation that recruitment and retention would improve. Is that happening?
It is. I do have some data numbers for you on that. So we've had almost 1,300 applications since in fiscal year 2016-2017, so that's up. I'm glad to report that 32% of those applications are people of color and 17% are female. So I think we're hitting the right audience for folks to become officers. Year-to-date, 25% of our new and rehired officers are people of color. So we're not only just trying to get bodies in the door, we're trying to diversify the organization at the same time. I have talked to officers who are laterals, and that pay incentive has helped. We have hired folks from the East Coast, and those pay incentives that council passed with a contract has helped quite a bit. So we are seeing enhanced, I guess, response for people searching out the Portland Police Bureau as a place to work.
Very good. And Chief, I'm sorry, I wasn't writing down quickly enough. You said 32% of the applications were people of color, 17% were female.
Yes.
And then you said something about the actual hires. Are the actual hires holding up those same proportions relative to the pool at large?
Just a few percentage points less in that. So 25% of the new and rehired officers are people of color, and 13.5-14% officers are identify as female.
And you're proposing only a 3% increase in new hires being female and 4% communities of color. Those seem relatively modest.
Yeah, I'm not sure if our personnel hiring manager is here yet, but we could answer that question now. Okay. I'm sorry, what?
We can wait till later.
Okay. Conversely, though, with the I believe that the contract that passed is helping our hiring quite a bit, especially, you know, lateral and new recruits from across the country. The issue with that, right, because with every positive probably comes a negative, we are delaying people who are retiring, which is good, because that's helping bridge that gap, which is important. But at some point in time, those folks are going to leave, and they're probably going to leave at the end of the contract cycle. So we are preparing for, thinking ahead, fiscal year 2020 to 2021, that time frame, anywhere from 100 and 140 people retiring in 1 year.
So,
yes, sir.
If I may, the 350 figure that you quoted for retirements within 5 years, the expectation is that that's going to be backloaded because of the end of the contract.
Exactly. Yeah, so instead of them kind of sporadically leaving over the next 5 years, we still expect that number to leave, just now kind of at the end of the cycle. So to address that issue, with the recruiting process, hiring process, background process, training process, you know, it's 18 months to 2 years or so when somebody kind of enters the system to become an officer on the street. We need to proactively think ahead, and potentially in a couple of years, if things go well, I'll be coming back to council and asking for overhire authority so we don't have those ebbs and flows of hires and retires. Okay, another issue, significant issue, is our equity and diversity, our racial equity plan, though it's not on OEHR's website yet. I have it on my desk. We're meeting next week. It's thick. It's comprehensive. I like it. That's essentially completed. We'll get that out. And a lot of folks diligently worked on that, very appreciative of it. We've had a number of internal and external trainings on equity issues, justice issues for our in-service next year. So we're currently in our in-service training cycle now, but for 2018, we're gonna have a whole series of implicit bias trainings, which to me is a big light bulb moment on implicit bias in the world.
Chief, who will that be for in 2018, the implicit bias training?
All our sworn members.
All sworn members will have implicit bias training next year. Good, thank you.
As I said before, we're focusing our recruiting efforts on people of color and females, and instead of, or in addition to, going to colleges and universities and seeing how other agencies across the United States are addressing that, we've kind of gone outside the box a little bit. So the Police Bureau met with Wyden and Kennedy to discuss ways to change the narrative in Portland on policing. How do they recruit women and people of color? And then we went out to Nike and met with their diversity and inclusion team to essentially ask the same question. Surprisingly to me, I would think there's lines of people waiting to go to work at Nike, and there wasn't. They too have quite similar issues with hiring a diverse workforce, which was kind of surprising. So it didn't really fix the problem for me, but it kind of gave me a different insight from the public sector, private sector world of trying to find a diverse workforce. So again, didn't solve the answers, but it gives me a better insight on hurdles we have to overcome to get an equitable workforce.
So I have a couple of questions on that.
Sure.
Are you specifically targeting Western Oregon University? Because my son went there. It has one of the few criminal justice programs in the state. It tends to be local people, and they have been really trying to recruit people of color to go there.
Yes. So all the local law enforcement agencies in the area, we're actually trying to get lateral officers from there. But all the Western, Northwest region academic institutions, we're working there. And we're even going backwards in time, if that makes sense, working with like Jefferson High School through PCC to have a public safety tract.
Mm-hmm.
So get youth interested who are going to high school who might want to go up to PCC and work that way. And then we're doing I'm very, very hopeful efforts with John Jay College in New York City, extremely diverse school that focuses on criminal justice issues. And we have some officers work here now from John Jay, so we have a lot of connections there. So
yeah, I'm just suggesting that particular local university is one
sure.
that deserves extra effort.
Yeah.
And the other question I have is, during the contract discussions, we talked about perhaps offering an incentive to university students that once they graduated that we would look into whether we can pay their student loans if they come to work with us. Is anything happening with that?
We're looking into that, trying to figure out how the mechanics of implementing that. I think that, in addition, though, would be another incentive that would, put Portland Police Bureau a little bit above other agencies that to get new officers interested in coming here. It's one of the many variables we're trying to figure out how to hire folks. Good idea. Thank you. So our decision packages, switching gears to that a little bit. Given budget shortfalls and staffing shortfalls and general fund resources, we didn't ask to start any new programs this year. We're just trying to maintain what we're currently doing. We're just trying to keep ahead of, some of our asks are for the DOJ support work, the use of data. I could probably never have enough data analysts, actually. There's always something to measure and always efficiencies involved there, but to have the use of data analysts is critical. The support for the survivors of sexual assault, every person who makes a report now within 48 hours is getting some type of follow-up from an advocate, which is crucial. The reduction packages, our requested budget of 2% reductions, $3.6 million. We put forth, obviously, the package for you today, but we focused on preserving diminished core services to the community. I guess I can't just stress that enough. No fault of anybody's. I think over the years, the core service delivery has kind of ticked down a little bit as the city's growing. It's good that the city's growing, obviously. So we're trying to preserve the core services as best we can. So if the reductions are taken, the likely result will be negative trends continuing with respect to response times. So one of the metrics we use is response times for a priority one 911 call. Somebody calls 911, highest priority call. One of the metrics is get there in 5 minutes. It's over six now, and that's just not a direct correlation, but it's a function of officers on the street and their workload to get to the call.
Chief, is that a local standard or is that a national standard?
It's more of a national standard. That's the metrics that many comparable agencies use.
Thank you.
Thanks. And then with that diminished response times and diminished community service delivery, then the perceptions of safety in the city diminish, and I believe you get this little bit of a snowball effect, which is evidence in some of the surveys. Mounted patrol unit, I'd be remiss if I didn't talk about that. I used to be one of the riders in the 90s. I mean, I think that's an enhanced walking beat. They do a little over 1,000 contacts a month with the public. Also, I think if you get rid of the mounted patrol unit, what you're actually doing too, I think a lot of the cost savings achieved by reducing the mounted patrol unit is the sergeant. And well, there's a sergeant and four officers and then four of our professional staff that are stable attendants and trainers, but the big ticket item there is the sergeant and four officers. So you'd be, to achieve that savings, you're actually cutting our sworn personnel. But
I have a question about that. Could you explain why it wouldn't be the case that you would move them over into regular service rather than cutting them?
Well, we could, but by cutting their wages and benefits, that's where the money, a good portion of the money savings comes in.
Well, I understand that, but in an environment where we don't have enough sworn officers, I mean, this isn't a cut that could possibly make sense, right? I mean, we have issues with recruiting and retaining officers, and we have a kind of a slow pipeline to get them on board, and we're talking about eliminating officers for budgetary reasons when we don't have enough officers as it is? I mean, that's, pardon my French, but that's crazy.
Yeah, so let me take another take on Rob's question here. For me, it's not a question of whether we need the officers and whether or not we need a community policing presence. I think we all agree we do. And your data shows that, and the public sentiment demonstrates that. The question is this the right vehicle? For me, the question is the horse a preferred vehicle to somebody walking the beat? And if the answer is yes, it's the horse, horses aren't free. Fortunately, my daughter doesn't want one. But I'm told by
yes.
My fellow dads that it's not an inexpensive proposition. And of course, there's a real estate question as well. Where do you put the horses?
Right.
And how do you care for the horses? And yeah, so for me, the question really is what's the marginal savings for getting rid of the horses, getting rid of the barn, getting rid of the maintenance, getting
right.
rid of whatever else I don't know about the joys of maintaining and owning a horse.
Chief, and by the way, I think it would be helpful if we went to your submission here, page 14. It says the unit currently consists of a sergeant, four police officers, an equestrian trainer, blah, 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 blah. Due to staffing shortages, three of the officers have been reassigned, so that answers part of your question, leaving just the sergeant and one patrol officer. Elimination, that is acceptance of this cut, would result in the reassignment of the sworn staff. So if I read that correctly in answer to the question, it sounds like we would not be eliminating the positions, we would just be eliminating the function. Can you clarify that?
We would be eliminating the FTE. That's where the dollar savings are. The people would move over into vacancies, so we wouldn't be laying anybody off. But the FTE has to be eliminated to realize the savings.
So you'd be transferring to one of the and you have 60, you have about 60 vacancies now or something?
52 sworn.
All right, so so that's, I think it goes from crazy to questionable, but it may not be crazy because they're still on the force. I want to just acknowledge that every budget year, you know, we have something like a Buckman pool, a mounted patrol, a community center, and that's where we get a lot of people come out, and we get competing T-shirts and lots of passion, and that's good. There are people in the community that care about all of these things. I do think we also have to acknowledge, however, that if we took this particular cut, we would also be freeing up a piece of dirt in the Centennial Mills footprint. that, based on the PDC projections, becomes a lot more valuable if that can be developed versus, or put it slightly differently, is a extremely high-cost facility for maintaining the horses. And so just I'll put down my own marker. Whatever we decide as to mounted patrol, I think we have to all grudgingly agree that we can no longer use dirt in the River District that has other development possibilities as the home. And if the horses are to be maintained, if that's the will of the council, and I think the last few years, a majority of the council has said we'd be willing to take this cut, even though it's a tough one, I don't think we can justify the facility in the River District.
So I want to second that, and you know the trade-off isn't just the horse patrol versus other things. In that particular example, the trade-off could easily be the maintenance of a horse barn for what sounds like it's now one person who rides the horse in exchange for potentially affordable housing in a riverfront parkway. And so the trade-off becomes much starker. I would like to also have, and I'm not saying this to be provocative, I really am just curious, and I know people watch this, and I agree with Commissioner Fish, I've heard that people care very deeply about the mounted patrol. I'd like to know more about that. Is it the presence of horses? People like horses, I like horses. There are other things we could do to get creative if it is that. For example, I love going to the Pendleton Roundup. I ride a horse. It's very dangerous for me to ride a horse because I only do it once a year at the Pendleton Roundup. But I note that there are a lot of young people all around this state who are really good at riding and maintaining horses, and maybe they'd like to come to Portland at our invitation on the weekends, and people could meet some of these people from other communities who love the horses. If alternatively it's the vehicle and there is some tactical reason why we want to maintain one or two horses instead of increasing our community policing presence, I'd like somebody to make that case, because from where I sit right now, I don't think it's an equal trade-off. I'd rather go towards a foot-based patrol and community policing, because I'm hearing far, far more about that than I am anything else when it comes to improving the relationship between the police bureau and the community, which is something the Department of Justice is pushing us hard to do.
Great questions. Anticipating some of these, I brought up today Sergeant Shell from the Horse Patrol Unit. Before I answer that, I would like to say, I agree with your comments, I think the horse is an amazing vehicle, since I used to ride one for a number of years for community policing. I do understand that horses can be expensive. Like, the best day you have in your life is when you buy a boat, and second best day is when you get rid of it, or vice versa. Horses fall in that same category. they really do. But you learn to love them. In terms of the property, though, it makes perfect sense to me that we should not be at Centennial Mills. That to me, that's all you need to say, right? We do have the ability, though, to at Rivergate, at the end of the St. John's Bridge, to move those cars. We can get into this in greater detail or later, obviously at your discretion, to move those cars over to the Property Evans Division and open up Rivergate as a location for the horses. But to answer more of the in-depth questions that you might have about community engagement, the vehicle, since Marty, Sergeant Shell, is currently in charge of that unit, I'll turn it over to him.
Good morning, Mayor, Commissioners. My name is Marty Shell. I'm the Sergeant of the Portland Police Bureau's Mounted Patrol Unit. I've been doing it for about 5 years there. We moved out of Centennial Mills in 2015, and the horses now live in Lake Oswego. We trailer them into work each day. The misconception there was that there's only one person riding them. They did downgrade us or sent officers back to the street. It's myself and one full-time officer right now. They did send three of our officers back to the street to take radio calls to patrol back in October. So it's two of us currently. There's also the four professional staff we have with the stable attendants and the trainer that would actually be laid off if the unit does close.
So how many stable attendants? There are four stable?
We have three FTEs, but there's four actual bodies because two are a job share.
Okay, and how many horses are there?
We have eight horses.
You have eight horses, and you have two riders, and you have four FTE to maintain the
three FTE,
eight
four three, people.
Say it again. So
three FTEs, four people. One is a job share.
Got it. Thank you very much. So three FTEs, four people to maintain the horses, plus two riders.
Yes.
And eight horses.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
When I go back and I collect the statistics from, and I'll go prior to October, because that was when we still had, after the budget cuts of 13-14, where we lost two bodies, for 2 years there, 3 years, we operated with four officers and a sergeant. And when we had that level of staffing, and part of it was operating out of Centennial Mills, the other part was operating out of Lake Oswego or Aurora when we were displaced, we were averaging about 1,300 citizen contacts a month. When we talk about the difference between the horse patrol and the walking beats or the bicycles or the cars, nothing is like the horses standing in the middle of Pioneer Square. And I mean, if you took bicycles and you took foot patrol and you put horses in the middle of Pioneer Square, the line to talk to the officers on the horses would be longer than the other two combined. It's the horse is the vehicle to engage the community. We've been, since our current operating base is kind of on the east side, we've been doing a lot more work on the east side of Portland, going up around 52nd Divisionary. We've made it that far in a day, down to Selwood. When we're doing that, we have people come out of their houses to talk to us, and they wouldn't do that if we were riding by on a bicycle or walking by or driving by in a car. It's the horse is that vehicle to engage the public. And so that really is where it's coming.
So I don't know.
Go ahead, just go ahead.
So what's the price tag? Three FTEs, eight horses, two riders annually. This is an outreach. This is an outreach function, I believe. So how much does it cost?
Correct. My understanding, you can correct me if I'm wrong here, is it's about $1.1 million total currently, but that includes all the salaries of the personnel. Mm-hmm. And the actual EMS, the external services, and the internal services is about $200,000 a year. So the rest of it is all personnel costs.
And other than community engagement, how are the horses used during rallies and protests?
For the last 2 years, we haven't really been used during that. Our mission has been focused primarily on the community engagement and the attending special events, the community events, parades, precinct open houses, different sporting events, things like that. The primary focus hasn't been on the crowd management and crowd control.
So just before we move on, I don't know if this one actually works, but anyway, I'm really okay. I was wondering. So you said it was about $200,000 for the non-sworn officer costs. Is that right?
No, sir. The personnel costs, the whole unit's about $1.1 million. Mm-hmm. The non-personnel costs are about $200,000. All the rest of it is personnel costs. So a round number is about $900,000 total is personnel cost.
Okay, so I guess what I'm trying to understand is, wasn't there a nonprofit that was paying for part of the cost of the horses? How much of that do they cover?
Excuse me. In the budget, I believe it was the 13-14 budget cuts, there was a $200,000 initial per year for those 2 years. $200,000 of that was donated to the city and put in trust, from what I understand, with the former mayor, understanding that would be used to find a permanent housing location. And then they had another $200,000 that is set aside, and they have about $465,000 right now they're willing to put towards the relocation of us to a permanent home.
Yeah, okay. I do want to clarify, because you were, I think, on the as a community advisor at that time. Yeah. The offer from the group was to help pay some of the operations costs. Later on, they said they really didn't want to pay operations costs. They wanted to pay for a new facility, and so that's the funding is being held in trust. It's not paying operations at this time.
I see. Okay. Thank you. That's very helpful. So I guess what I want to understand, and I'm sorry that I still don't, is how much does it cost to maintain the horses, not counting the Centennial Mills facility, but just the horses and the people who care for the horses and not any of the sworn officers who ride them? Because, I mean, those, whether or not that cut is taken, I mean, they're 56 vacancies or something like that, and if four are cut, I mean, that, okay. But there's a cost associated, just as Mayor Wheeler says, for the vehicle. And that's and how much is that cost on an annual basis?
I don't know how much the individual cost is for the professional staff per person that's better.
I just want the aggregate cost.
The cost per horse that I budget every year is about $5,000 a year operating for the horse, and that includes the feed, the veterinary care, those sorts of things.
So that's $40,000 for the horses. And then there's some cost for the four people, three FTE, who care for them. And I guess that's what we're kind of looking at is the real cost. I mean, that, and I don't want to set aside the cost of housing them either, because that's a real cost too. And if it's not going to be Centennial Mills and it continues to exist, it's got to be somewhere. But I think it would be very helpful for everyone to understand just how much we're talking about for just the horses. Because throwing the horses and the officers together, I understand they're part of a whole, but it sort of muddles it a little bit in my mind. Thank you.
And I would estimate, just based on the salaries I understand from hiring, the non-sworn staff with benefits and everything would be about $200,000 for those three FTEs.
Could I make this recommendation of the budget office? Since I don't want to take too much more of your time on this particular item, although it is interesting. You've only got a little over a half an hour, and so maybe the budget office could provide us a very specific breakdown of the costs of operating this particular program per Rob's questions. I think they're great questions, and I'd like to see those answers as well.
Yep, happy to do that.
And if you could also add transportation costs into the mix.
So I have only two more points, and we'll get into the more Q&A session. So during the horse issue question, Catherine informed me that the graffiti funding by ONI a number of years ago was one-time dollars. And then the last thing I want to talk about is the body camera program, because I think there might be some misinformation out there. I want to let everybody know that I'm very much in favor of body cameras. I would also, if money wasn't an object, Central Precinct tested out a number of years ago in-car cameras, and those cars have five cameras in it, you know, forward, reverse, side to side, and into the transportation area of that. I would love it if every officer had a body-worn camera integrated into the car camera system. I think that adds to the transparency issues. I think when those videos go out and the public can see it, it alleviates some of the trust issues. So, yes, I'm very much in favor of the body-worn camera system. We are in the process of hiring a manager to oversee that. Purchasing the cameras is the easy part of that, talking to multiple agencies across the country. The hard part is the infrastructure, the public records requests, and each state's a little bit different because the public records request laws are different. The secured server cost, the when you go to trial, the district attorney's office is going to want that video, defense attorney will want that video, the preparation, redaction of those videos, and the policy that goes with it. That's the more difficult process to go through. So the budget portion we did is simply, we're not going to buy the secured servers this year, so we don't need that in our budget. We're kind of moving that downstream a little bit. But we are hiring a program manager to take on that task because it is expensive, the full package, but I think it's money definitely well spent for the outcomes that you get from it.
Chief, could I ask you a question about that? And I appreciate you stating very clearly your position on it. A number of communities, I believe Seattle may even be one, rolled out these body-worn cameras with great fanfare for all the reasons that you just suggested, and now they're withdrawing those programs because it turns out they're not just expensive, they are prohibitively expensive. And as you pointed out, it's not the camera that's the problem, it's the data management and the systems involved in actually providing the information, culling it and providing it. And it concerns me, number one, given the large upfront cost associated with it at a time where we've all just said we you know, our top priority is more community engagement and more community policing. I would like to see a very detailed, longer-term plan. You know, what is the first year plan, the second year, the third year, the fourth, the fifth? How does the entire rollout look? How many FTEs are involved? What are the systems cost associated with this? What are we anticipating based on other cities' experiences with regard to public records requests and the costs? What I don't want to do is go down the road where other cities have invested millions and millions of dollars in the hardware, the training, the enterprise systems, just to find out that this is really a $10 to $15 million a year proposition that we can't afford. So before we jump in with both feet, I would want to know more than that. Is that what you're trying to do here with this FTE?
Yes. Well said. Yes, because a lot of agencies, comparable size agencies, they jumped at it, and now they're pulling back. So it's overly expensive because all the minutia detail that. They probably didn't research it deeply enough. I still think, though, and I'll have Christy answer some of this too, once we get those costs for you, and as technology moves forward, right, or the advances now than versus what they had 3 years ago are phenomenal, so we're always going to have that technology iterative cycle. But it's hard to put, though they are expensive, and I'll turn over to Christy, I think it's hard to put a dollar cost on the community trust building you receive from that.
Can so if I may just finish this line and I'll get to you, Commissioner. Unfortunately, this is the budget process, and we
right.
have to put a dollar cost on everything.
Right.
And that therein lies the problem. Has there been any effort to collaborate with other communities on the data management process or the infrastructure required or the administrative overhead required in responding to public records requests? Is there some way for 10 large cities to get together and try to take advantage of economies of scale here?
I would say it'd be very, very hard to do because of all those shared data systems that have to collaborate. That could be an answer, but that, not saying that that's not a possibility, but that's to me, I'm not an IT person. That seems like a significant added layer of complexity.
Just real quick, Mayor and Council, I actually called Seattle this week to talk to their body camera program manager. In addition to Albuquerque, New Mexico, and San Francisco, other major cities that have made big splashes in the news with funding body cameras, they've had a very difficult time with implementing them. So Seattle, for example, their program manager has dedicated $2.25 million of ongoing support. They don't have the policy in place. They have concerns with union bargaining issues. And these are things that are holding up the ability to continue to move forward. And his advice was quite strongly that having those policies and procedures in place before you do the RFP will serve you better off, particularly if you're looking at the cost of data and record storage. That if you do your RFP now and then your policy and procedure requires more record storage than you were anticipating, you might not have the resource available. So they were very cautionary on that. San Francisco added 11 positions, primarily in their legal research and support department. So those are positions for looking at public disclosure, legal requirements, and making sure that the information does go out appropriately. And I think that's where the ability to do what you have suggested on looking at what a phased rollout looks like and how those costs and would layer on top of each other hopefully would help with our vendor selection and moving the project forward.
Thank you. Commissioner Fritz has been waiting patiently.
Thank you. I just wanted to say for the two new members of the council, we did have a hearing on going ahead and purchasing body cameras. At that point, there was a lot of community concern about whether this is in fact in the community's best interest. They were curious about how it would work for officer accountability. We also heard a lot of concerns about privacy and police using these cameras to surveil the community. As you say, the policies would be very important. That was one of the big issues under the contract bargaining and acceptance process. I mean, there's things like privacy. If they're supposed to be on all the time, do the officers wear them while they go into the bathroom? Once you've got this data, it's public record, and so you could have somebody, the news media, for example, asking for the public record of somebody on the worst day of their lives because the police have gone to a home where there's something tragic happened. So there was a lot of community pushback in addition to how much does it cost and can we afford it?
Correct, and that's why we're hiring a program manager, and their task is to do everything that council has suggested to get those.
The reason I'd like to see a long-term plan, I mean, I'd like to know if this is even feasible. I'm not sold yet. I see the value from a communications and a transparency perspective, but if it turns out it's getting to a large enough number of FTE and large enough system costs that we're really just spitting into the wind, I think we should know that up front before we make a huge investment and frankly lead the community to believe we're going to do something that we may not be able to deliver on. I'd rather, you know, under-promise and over-deliver.
I agree, and that's, I think, in a nutshell, why we don't have body cameras today, because we're trying to judiciously explore these hurdles we have to overcome to implement the body-worn cameras. We're not spending money and then coming back to you and going, oh, we didn't think of everything.
What about the dash cams? Where does that fit in the hierarchy of accountability and transparency? And is it true that we actually have not fully deployed dash cams yet in the Portland Police Bureau?
I think there's seven cars at Central? Eight. So there's eight cars at Central Precinct where we did a pilot project. Again, that's the five cameras per car. A little bit easier issues, I would say, because they're not going into private spaces, right? I think to Commissioner Fritz's point, you know, unless you're driving incredibly poorly, the car is not going to land in somebody's front yard in their house, right? So those privacy issues just didn't come up with that. But I don't have this data, but I can get it for you. The complaints that IPR took, excuse me, where we had car camera footage, either resolved faster. It was very, very beneficial to have that video. So I think the car camera portion is easier. And I think to outfit the cars, though, is more expensive. So I'd have to research for you what, you know, body camera comparison versus car camera comparison.
Do most of the cities that roll out the body cameras, you mentioned, you know, Seattle rolled it out, pulled it back, Albuquerque, others, do they already have a full deployment of dash cams? Do we know?
I'll let the research that and get back to you. I'm not sure.
I'd like to know. Thank you.
So,
Chief Marshman,
why hire a program manager when there's no program? I mean, it sounds to me like you need somebody like a consultant as opposed to a program manager.
To do the research and analysis as this goes on. Technology changes pretty quick. I think a cost of a program manager is going to be cheaper than the cost of a consultant on this.
But it just seems to me that you're hiring somebody who's going to have an expectation of having a job for, you know, a career. And there's no assurance there's a career associated with this position yet. And indeed, the more I hear about the cost, it sounds less and less likely that there is going to be a program.
Well, part
so
of
why create the full-time equivalent position when I would argue, and I think we would all agree, there's other urgent needs within your bureau, as opposed to getting a top-notch consulting team who can assess out all these costs for you?
When we met with the IT department, some of the things they talked about was we do have other IT needs. Program managers, the FTE, could be shifted. So I think there's some potential benefit there. We do have MAVs. We do have license plate readers, other technology that have impacted this position. And the cost for consultants are more than likely going to be significantly more than an FTE.
I'm not going to belabor the point, but it sounds to me now you're telling me this program manager is migrating into all these other issues too, so it's not just a program manager for body cameras.
The value of the FTE.
Okay.
This is a specific program for body cameras.
Okay, totally switch gears. Are all our rape kits processed?
Yes. I do have specific data for you on that.
Well, I mean, yes is good enough for me.
Okay.
Chief Marshman, I don't believe the body cams were a quick requirement of our DOJ settlement, but I believe that there's a hope or belief within the community that they would build on public trust and create more transparency and accountability. But what I'm hearing from some of the advocates in the community is the way that we are planning on implementing this program, they don't feel that there's a net gain for the community toward those aims. Can you speak to that at all?
A little bit. I can't remember if we had four or five community sessions on body-worn cameras, what they are, what we'd like to use them for, policy discussions. If by chance in the future we actually do move forward with implementing a body-worn camera program, we'll do more of those because technology advances so quickly, there's probably new variables to discuss. It is a balance there. That's why we're going to have and rely on community input to get our policy developed correctly to satisfy as many needs as we can.
So I guess I remain a little bit confused because what I'm hearing from community members, and as we all know, they're not always completely informed, and neither are we, but Commissioner Fritz is expressing concern about privacy, and community members are expressing concern that they actually wouldn't have access to the footage in a timely manner. Are you aware of this concern?
Well, timely manner is an IT question. we're having a hard time right now with public records requests. Public records requests in the IT world is a whole new area. So,
aren't there also policies around when footage would be released?
Yes. One is just the sheer ability to pull the video, review the video, redact. Sensitive information, get it out. That's just a workload issue. some of the ability to get stuff up, it depends on what the type of call is or the crime is. So involving youth versus a car prowl report, right? There's going to be different variables in the types of crime. Here are the privacy issues that I think would be difficult for a policy reason. Again, it comes back not to get in the weeds for you, but when do you have the camera on, when do you have the camera off?
If
I go to, if an officer goes to your home.
I hope not. No offense, guys.
Someone innocuous. Let's say somebody broke in your car and stole something out of the back of your car. And it's not today, but it's a rainy day in Portland, and you ask the officer, hey, why don't you come on into my house, take the report. And let's say the policy says the camera's on. Could somebody do a public records request for that footage? It's nothing juveniles related. It's just a random car prowl report. Do we give access to the public for the footage inside your home?
Hmm.
That's one of many questions along those lines to where, the policy for body-worn cameras is much more difficult than a policy for our in-car cameras, right? It's those privacy issues.
And my instinct is that it shouldn't be public because I'm not the criminal, I'm not the person that's potentially committed a crime, but I realize there's probably more to it than that.
Yeah, you could think of a lot of different scenarios, a lot of different variables. That's why that policy is think to get it right is quite difficult.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
Chief, you have about 15 more minutes. Commissioner Fish.
I'm done with my presentation, so this is all.
Oh, you're done.
It's all Q&A.
Commissioner Fish and then Pam. Well, Pam, why don't you go ahead and we'll get to Commissioner Fish next.
Thank you very much for your presentation this morning.
Thank you.
My question, and this is my own education, you were talking about a number of cities that you've contacted that are rolling out plan and are having difficulty with it. Have you also contacted cities that are there cities that have successfully had these programs in place for quite some time, and are you connecting with them to see how they do them and potentially asking about their policies? I mean, to me that seems like the natural mm-hmm. first step.
Yes. In a word, Oakland is a city that has had cameras on officers for a few years now. I think they have had some lessons learned, and there it's Albuquerque, New Mexico has also had cameras. So these are areas where making the phone calls and talking to them, another reason why having a dedicated resource to do that legwork up front for the lessons learned is also very valuable.
Right. Commissioner Fish.
Thank you, Mayor. Chief, I have a lightning round. So yes, no, or could I just get a follow-up to this? You mentioned with respect to the DOJ settlement that we're about 96% completed in terms of action items?
No, clarifying, because I want to get this right for action, like the yellow. So it's some are green and some are actions taken to reach the green accomplished. So actions taken. So not, what's that?
Assigned to PBD.
True. Not all the actual items are ours. Some are for BOIC, some are for IPR, some are for council. So the ones assigned to PBB, substantially complied with or moving towards completion.
Okay. And because there's a lot of moving pieces, could I just request a one-pager that just elaborates on what you have in your budget submission that just shows status on all those items and how you get to 96%? And I understand that that doesn't include COAB and other pieces. Number two, I've heard from a lot of small businesses a recurring theme of frustration that someone shoplifts or there's some other, it's a fairly lower level crime that occurs, but nonetheless is very disruptive. And in our current system, it is not a priority. Other more serious offenses get attention. And so it could take 4 or 5 hours to have someone respond and then the impact on just running their business. Any comment?
Well, lightning round. The answer is yes, you're correct. But it's not as simple as staffing issues, though staffing does is the delay in getting there. We can have a deeper conversation now or at some point in time.
Well, I'd like to have a follow-up conversation on that. And I promised a number of groups that I'd even convene some of the professionals just to have that conversation because I think they need to hear what the challenges are and also they need to know more about what they can do proactively.
Yes. It'd be a great conversation because, you know, what's the nature of the person? Why are they committing a crime? The district attorney's office and how they follow up on those level of crimes is, I think, also an important variable. So it'd be a good conversation.
I'm almost done. We have a state law, Chief, that prohibits the use of public resources to enforce federal immigration laws. Are we in full compliance with that law?
Yes, we are.
There's been a lot of security issues that have come up in the last few months at City Hall involving both electeds and staff. I won't go into all the details. I will say that my sense is you and the folks that report to you have been incredibly responsive, and I want to publicly thank you for that because it has been a challenging time for a lot of people.
And thank you very much.
We appreciate the responsiveness and the attention that you've given to that.
Thank you. I'll pass that on.
And then finally, when the police contract was voted on and passed, one of the rationales that got the council to support the contract was that you were at risk of having to cannibalize specialty units to put people on the street, and that includes domestic violence investigations, all kinds of things. As a result of the contract, where are we heading in terms of the specialty units that were at risk of being cannibalized?
So I did not touch youth or family services, but I did pull back from other specialty units. That's that 25% figure number. At some point in the future, I would like to bolster those specialty units back up because they do have a unique niche in certain areas in the community to be more responsive than the average patrol officer, which some folks are experts in their area and other folks have to be generalists. So the officer on the street, I think, is more general because they're hitting a variety of issues where homicide detectives, as an example, that's a specialty. So 25% reduction. With our recruiting efforts, we won't see any relief, if you will, until 2018. I believe we have 50-ish or so officers coming off probation in 2018. So it's going to take a few years to, again, it's that two-year cycle to get an officer hired and trained and functioning on the street on their own. So my goal is, sorry, it's probably a longer answer than you want, it's going to take a little bit of a while to get back up, and my goal is to bolster those specialty units back to the level they are. But I really didn't talk too much about here, but the RFP that I'm trying to get will address this, is the facilities plan, the city's growing, the county's growing, you know, not just fiscal year to fiscal year to fiscal year, But what are we going to be looking at 5 years from now, 10 years from now? What's technology going to be? What's the needs of the city? What's the population of the city? And not get behind that eight ball. Because I think once you get behind that power curve, super hard to catch up. I'm just trying to maintain, not even maintain. I mean, I think we're slowly ebbing down. We will eventually catch back up and then continue on to produce a service for the city that it's going to need infrastructure-wise.
Ryan, you had a question?
Yeah, I have an offer and a question. With the rollout of the racial equity plan, OHR also rolled out a racial equity toolkit, and just wanted to offer the use of that when looking at policies like body camera usage. It really helps to identify unintended consequences and trade-offs and mitigate those, and then a core to it is engagement with communities of color and refugees. And so really having that dialogue will help to address some of the policy issues that were raised here.
Yeah, I agree.
And then a question. You mentioned earlier a community engagement plan that's heavily informed by data, and I'm assuming that has, you know, your community policing is rolled into that. And so wanted to understand more, how do you assess the relevance and effectiveness of different community engagement and policing plans to people of color and immigrants and refugees? It was hard for us to really suss out when looking at like a mounted patrol unit versus the GREAT or the STRENGTH program that have more of a presence in north and east, how the relevance and effectiveness of those programs are in comparison. And so it's good to have quantity data, like 1,000 contacts per year.
Right.
But what's the quality?
The quality
would be helpful. And specifically, that's disaggregated by race and ethnicity.
Yeah, very good question. So not getting too much into the weeds on surveys, but we use DHM with some of our surveys, use Portland State with some of our surveys, and we can aggregate that data. Conversely, if we do, and we've done this in the past, if we do a walking beat on Hawthorne, we do pre and post measurements, we do surveys, and the auditor could probably speak to much better auditing standards than I can. But if you do pre and post surveys of a small N sample, there's just not enough numbers of that sample to get some of the detail you're asking for. So I agree that it's needed, but depends on the structure of the survey you have and other different measurement tools. So we tend to rely on Portland State and DHM and other surveying experts, and other avenues to do that. So we've worked, tried to work with private sector companies that do this kind of work as well to try to figure out more unique ways other than just survey mechanisms to get to that data. But I agree with your question completely, and what you're asking for is what we're trying to do.
Commissioner Udaly.
I also have a little lightning round for you.
Okay.
So I'm hearing conflicting stats on overall crime. I've heard that crime is down overall, but we're seeing that calls are up. So I'm wondering if that is specific types of crime, or we're seeing more concentrated activity in areas where, you know, there's concentrated poverty and a lack of services and a lack of economic opportunity. Can you speak to that at all?
Yeah, you actually kind of answered it. It's the latter.
Yeah.
What our analysts have done is broken up the city in 500 by 500 square foot grids. Mm-hmm. So instead of looking at the city as a whole, you get a more general idea of what's going on. But some of those grids in the city, depending on where you are, ask the community that lives there, and they will say crime is up. And then you start stratifying what those issues are. Person crimes, property crimes, livability crimes, and then you start customizing. I believe what you should do, you start customizing your service as best you can for those pockets in the community. And we do that with our community engagement strategies on our computers, and we could have greater, much detailed conversation for you on this. So we try to address not the city as a whole, but specific needs of specific communities and specific areas, and try to customize the service we deliver.
I'd love to see those.
We'll set all that up for you. Yeah.
Great.
Yeah.
And then could you just briefly explain what what resources are being put towards hate crime graffiti through the Bureau?
We have one. When you get hate crime graffiti notified to us, we have detectives assigned to that. So we have two detectives assigned to bias crimes in general.
Because we're looking at increasing funding for that issue through ONI, so I want to make sure we're working in concert. I really hope we don't reduce funding for the strength programs. I just want to put that out there. I saw a comment that it's not reducing crime, but I argue that it's reducing the likelihood of certain people becoming victims, I guess.
Yes.
And that's important. And then I just had a quick question. As far as our sex assault victim advocate, we have paid advocates at the county, and we have volunteers that meet victims at hospitals. What is the added service or benefit we're getting through the Bureau on this item?
Yeah, I'll add to this, and I'll turn over to Christy as well. So the added benefit is contact with every person who makes a report, and then help that person navigate the very complex legal system. And some people make reports and don't want to follow through with it. So just basically, it's the humanity piece of that, to where there's a human connection for every person who essentially has the courage to report that kind of a.
But I mean, that's similar to what the county does. So I'm just, does the person choose who they're going to work with, the police bureau or the county or?
My understanding from speaking with the sex crimes unit, the SCU, is that this works with the detective on the investigation, which is separate of the prosecution
okay.
services that happen at the county. So you're dealing with the individual in those early moments of reporting, going through the hospital, and you're starting to go through a process that historically has many barriers for survivors mm-hmm. of sex assault to bring a case forward.
That's it. Thank you.
Commissioner Fritz, and this will have to be the last unless... Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, so Frieda will do you right after.
And actually, Mayor,
Frieda first.
If we could have a minute as well, just we'll be fast.
Very good.
Go ahead.
I also have several either questions or comment. On the police patrol, it seems like that's a limited area. I'm way out east. I've never seen a horse out there, of course, but it's quite a distance from where they keep the horses. So that is a very limited area that you're covering.
I'm sorry, for the horse patrol unit?
For the horse patrol.
One of the goals I would like to do is move them around the city more. I used to ride from downtown up to Kenton, so we can get there. But it is by design a little more limited.
More local.
Sure.
On retirees, you're hiring what I call, they would be double dippers, as we say at the school district.
That is true.
Now, with the school district, when we do that, we save significantly because we don't pay into PERS and other things. Is there any savings by hiring these retirees versus a new hire?
I have to get back to you on more specificity for that one.
Okay.
Unless,
no.
Okay.
Well,
it's a significant savings.
Are they more, sorry, because this is a good question, I'll let you, are they more expensive?
The issue is, in a nutshell, the folks that are retiring now are on the Fire Police
right.
Disability Retirement
mm-hmm.
Plan, which is paid for under
right.
a separate tax
yeah.
levy. When they are rehired, they're hired onto a PERS program, the officer program. The general fund does not pay for that. The police bureau is reimbursed for all sworn PERS costs by the FPDR fund. So FPDR pays whether it's an FPDR
right.
pension
yeah.
or whether it's a PERS pension for the retiree in the first case or the actively working employee in the second case.
And they would be third tier PERS.
They'd be, yes, fire police per OPSERP employees.
Yeah. Okay. Could you tell me the status of the SRO program? I saw it wasn't asked to be eliminated this time, which is great.
That was my question.
Our school board people here were asking these questions.
It's alive and well, and again, that's one of the units I'd like to continually expand because that connection between youth at schools, that's one of those you're not a generalist, you're an expert with things concerning youth in that school system. Wonderful program, and I'd like to add to that, honestly.
Well, I understand with my discussions with our superintendent that this past year, and I understand where
cuts and stuff, that during the summer they were pulled back onto patrol mainly, which is fine because schools aren't in session. During the school year, they still were doing a little patrol, was my understanding, or focusing just on it?
Yeah. Per Assistant Chief Urihara, who oversees that, is a 25% pullback during the school year. And it's again, this just comes, unfortunately, right down to staffing. But okay. I would like to have that 100% plus.
Are we looking at that same 25% this next year?
Hopefully with our hiring and the contract that passed and kind of bridging the gap of connectivity, hopefully not.
Okay. That's a great program, and I think it serves two purposes.
Multiple purposes. Prevents kids
from going to gangs. You said you have a program at Jefferson trying to work and bring kids into the program. Have you thought of expanding that and going out to Douglas? We have the most diverse population around with 3,000 students. Yeah, David Douglas.
Yeah. Your question is to hire?
No, to go out and start. We're doing a lot with STEAM career education, and we're quite organized that way. And have you thought to work with David Douglas to get a program going out there to, because we do have the diversity that you want?
We'll
explore to it.
Okay, yeah. It's just a suggestion.
Right, yeah.
We're known to be a high school that works very well with all the other entities. And the last one has to do with your community engagement and people that serve, say, on your budget advisory. You have a lot of advisory committees, is my understanding. In the past, and it's not just your bureau, it's many bureaus. In East Portland, we have a lot of diversity. East Portland Action Plan has worked very hard to get diverse people on these various committees. But often what we hear, they be on it for a year, but they feel they're not accepted. It's not a welcoming environment on a lot of these committees. So if you're getting someone who isn't as outspoken as I am, they end up backing off and dropping out. And I've heard this from our Russian, Latino, different ones that have served on these committees. So are you doing anything to revamp the committee so they're more welcoming, so people stay on them?
Good question. So the short answer is yes. The more longer answer is that community engagement unit we're trying to build. It's for that. One of the issues is to fix is that one. So one is to keep the data on it, because I could give you all kinds of charts all day long on all kinds of things. But how many community engagement activities did you do last week? I'd have a hard time to pull that together. So I think the data is valuable. But we have African American Advisory Council, Slavic Councils, the Muslim Educational Trust, and we're working in these groups more to make it more welcoming and acceptable to work with government, to work with the police, and keep them connected. And one of the things I'd like to explore this coming fiscal year is it's almost like more of like a UN model, because they're still kind of siloed amongst themselves, right? So bring everybody together to have these topics. So the short answer is yes, I understand that concern, and two, we're trying to solve that issue as well. Thank
Commissioner
you.
Fritz.
So colleagues on the Community Budget Committee and also on the Council, there's a $3 million problem with the allocations by the City Budget Office, including $2.6 million in this police budget, and that is on the allocation of the recreational marijuana tax. So 3% tax, which the Council referred to the voters for May of last year. And Commissioner Fish, Commissioner Saltzman will remember that we had an extended discussion about at Council about what that would be used for and how the community would be involved in deciding how that would be used. We directed it into a specific recreational marijuana tax fund within the Revenue Bureau. Commissioner Saltzman's urging, which I now appreciate, that it would not, the budget committee for this particular tax would not be located within the Office of Neighborhood Involvement, that there would be a separate process. So when we took it to the ballot, when I did the campaign, then Representative, now State Senator Lou Frederick, had a argument in favor, saying that it needed to be used, it could be used for expungement of records for people who were negatively impacted by cannabis laws in the past. Jesse Horton, the president of the Minority Cannabis Business Associations, also had a voter's pamphlet statement urging that it could be used for supporting small businesses, especially those who had previously not had access. So And we did say in both the ballot measure and in the resolution that there would be an annual council vote. So while technically adopting the budget will be an annual vote, 2.1 million of the cannabis tax is allocated to the service coordination team in the budget office's recommendation, 500,000 to the traffic division, with no community involvement about what are we going to do with it. Now, the challenge is also that it's not even the end of the first quarter yet, so we don't actually know how much we're going to get in because it comes in quarterly. And my understanding had been that we were going to wait to see how much we got in until the end of the fiscal year and then have a process in the fall to then allocate that in retrospect, and that we would not be assigning it to ongoing needs, certainly without the community input, which we absolutely promised. I went to 25 neighborhood associations to pass the tax, and I was very clear that we were going to have a community process to figure out what to do with it. So I'm just, obviously, it's just putting this issue on the table. I don't know where the other 400,000 has been allocated by the city budget office, but all of our reputations or trust with the community would be violated if we don't have a specific process to discuss the marijuana tax.
And perfectly timed, Andrew Scott will be the last word for today. And I want to assure everybody here that this is not the last time we will have to deliberate on the police bureau or any of these other bureau discussions, nor is this the last time we'll have representatives in front of this group. This is just sort of the first beginning. Tentative step in our budget process. But Andrew?
Yeah, no, thanks, Mayor. And thank you, Commissioner Fritz. That was actually the point I wanted to make sure got put on the table during this conversation so that everyone could hear it. This is one of the key recommendations that CBO is making in terms of balancing the city budget this year. And again, we've got a $4.3 million shortfall. And our recommendation is to take $2.6 million of the recreational marijuana tax fund and use it to support these police bureau programs. That is consistent with the city code in terms of how the funds will get allocated, but we can't speak to whether it's consistent with the conversations you've had with the community. But I do think the key question for council this year is do we use this to help solve this deficit? And these the service coordination team and traffic division are allowable uses of the fund as passed by the voters, or do we go out and talk about potentially setting up new programs? And as you've heard, my caution every year when we talk about this is, you know, setting up new programs and new expectations would mean we'll have to take cuts elsewhere. And so we certainly don't recommend cutting the service coordination team or traffic division. We just recommend the realignment. If we don't use marijuana funds for those, we'll need to find $2.6 million from some other city program in order to solve the deficit.
Great. Thank you. Thank you for your presentation.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Everybody for your questions. Next up, we have the Fire Bureau. Thank you, Chief.
Yeah.
harder. It's harder.
Hi, Ryan. Thanks for
All right, folks, we're running a little bit behind here.
We'll get at least half funded, but we're trying to. But is it just realignment?
Oh, no worries, Cheryl. Yeah, it's good to see him, glad you're here.
Thank you. It's nice seeing you. Thank you so much.
Hi. How are you?
So far, so good.
Well, good morning, folks. We now have the Portland Fire and Rescue budget presentation before us from now until noon. Chief, take it away.
Thank you, Mayor, and Commission, thank you as well. Members from the Community Budget Advisory Committee, thank you for having us here today. It is my
microphone now. On? There you go. I'm so sorry.
And Chief, if you could just identify yourself for the record.
I will. My name is Mike Myers, Fire Chief for the City of Portland. To my left, Bobby Regan, who has graciously helped us with the Budget Advisory Council here in, right with the Bureau itself, and Glenn Devitt. Thank you for being here today. They will assist us here shortly. And to my right, you'll recognize Jay Guo, who's been with us for quite a while. Jay's our Finance Manager with the Bureau. About a little over 8 months ago, I had an opportunity to interview for a position as your Fire Chief. And we had some very interesting discussions during that time frame. And one of those discussions was that my interest in bringing modern business practices to the fire service. It is my absolute pleasure and honor to have the opportunity to serve as your fire chief today. I'm going to do something that's probably a little different than what you're used to. I hope you'll give me that liberty to do that. We spent an inordinate amount of time, as most bureaus do, putting together their budget guidelines or budget position. And the way I'm going to present it today, it maybe is a little different. So. Bear with me as we go through this this process. I will talk for maybe 15 minutes or so. I'll give Bobby and Glenn an opportunity to speak as well, because I think it's important that you hear from the community members that assisted us. And then we have obviously plenty of time to answer questions. When you move into a new community as a fire chief, there's a process, obviously, of looking at how the operation is run. I did my cursory review and started with what is typically the area where you'll start, and that is looking at the current strategic plan for the Fire Bureau. We have a current strategic plan. It is very well written. It comes in a very nice, glossy booklet. It is we hired a consultant to put it together. It is about a 30,000-foot view of a modern municipal fire bureau. It is very well done, very well thought out. It's quite obvious that a great deal of work was put into it, and I think it has a great basis, a very good foundation. However, when we're evaluating what the potential is of a fire bureau or any other bureau, it is of our interest to understand a couple of things. One, how many people and who was involved in putting the strategic plan together, and number two, does that strategic plan, after talking with those individuals, honestly allow yourself to reach the potential that you think you can get? One of my first objectives was to start visiting fire stations when I got here. I've interviewed over 700 firefighters in putting what is now a new strategic plan together, largely because I felt like the current strategic plan did not include the majority of the fire department in interviews and in discussions of where the strategic plan, where they felt they could take this department. These are our most valuable staff members. Nor did I believe the current strategic plan can help us reach our potential. So I know you can't see the screen behind you. Some of you can. Commission and Mayor, you can't. However, it's okay. It's okay. I have it up here on this board as well. I'm not expecting you to read the detail. It's a large poster, so rest assured I'm not expecting that. I do want you to understand that we're shifting gears a little. This is a little bit different of approach. We're not producing a booklet form of a strategic plan for our bureau. We're doing it a little differently. This is a mind map. It's from a company called Coggle. Coggle's a small associated group with Google. We use this mind map to identify our main priority and what our lead goal is going to be. And right in the middle of that picture is a gray rectangle. And inside that gray rectangle, it says by 2020, Portland Fire Rescue is going to be world class. By 2020, from where we are today, we would like to take this bureau from where it is to world class. And I was asked multiple times throughout the interviews. We did over 110 site visits, over 90 station visits, over 3 months period of time. Multiple times during those site visits, we were asked, Chief, that's great, but where did you get the definition for world class, and who are we following to set this? And here's my answer. Portland is a great city. It's a great fire bureau. It's one of the best fire bureaus, I believe, in the country. And in the fire industry itself, from fire departments around this country and around the world, the fire industry is looking at us to set the trend. It's looking at these major cities within the United States to set the trend to be what world class could be for the fire service, not us following and emulating someone else. Our responsibility in the fire service is to set the trend so people look at us. We are designing the future. We describe what world class is going to be. We set the trend. In doing that, it takes bold goals, bold initiatives, responsible planning, strategic planning, and responsible funding, the ability to control costs, control call volume, manage outcomes. That's what this budget presentation is going to be about. I will do my best to draw off the data from the strategic plan and equate it to the current budget requests and current budget reductions we've talked about. That you already have in front of you. I'm sure you've read all these. So it's a little bit different, I know, but please, I'll explain it just a little bit right now so you'll maybe have a better understanding. You'll see on there the gray box in the middle. That is our primary goal. We do want to be world-class by 2020. It is a very bold goal. It should be bold. The six green lines that you see, the left side is what I call back of house. It's everything that we do in the back of house that you don't normally see. It's logistics, organizational culture and climate, finance, operations, all those things that you typically do in the back of the house. On the right side, there are three other blue lines. That's all of our front of house stuff, operations, fire prevention, putting fires out, medical calls, public health stuff, everything you might see from us, the bells and whistles. It's all in the front of the house on the right side. Those are our areas of business. The orange lines that you see after the blue lines, those are our big goals. Those are our big ideas. Those are the things that I've asked the Bureau from everybody, every firefighter, every mechanic, everybody that helps us with administration, every chief. Where can we possibly go? Help us get there, set these big goals, and that's what those orange ones are. Those are our large big goals. The red ones are the most critical. The red ones after the orange lines, those are our performance metrics. There are a bunch of them. This is a lot of, it's 90, keeping the fire to the room of origin 90% of the time, getting out of the barn in 60 seconds or 90 seconds 90% of the time, having a cardiac arrest survivability rate for our community that's greater than 20%, getting a CFIA accreditation. There's multiple things on there, big, big goals that's going to take a lot of work. The interesting thing about the strategic plan I think you need to know. Most strategic plans, and just in my experience, and you may have different experiences, this is just my experience, is when I went through many strategic planning processes in my career, we do a great job putting them together. We have a great booklet. We get it through the council or the commission, and everybody's extremely excited about it, and there's a lot of congratulatory going around. But the book sits on a shelf and never really gets seen again. This is different. It's expected to be different. These posters will hang in every fire station. Twice a month, two-hour meetings, twice a month, we take each blue section and we go down every performance measure and every manager's in the room, trying to find out where we're going, what the current performance measure is, and how can we get it to green. You'll notice they're all red today. They're red, the color red, because that's where we're at. They're all going to be out of compliance when we start. We're starting with right where we're at with the norm with compliance today. Our goal is to get to green. So over the three-year time frame, we're going to use this Coggle to go all the way around it, over and over and over, driving change from red to yellow to green. That's how we plan on taking ourselves from where we're at today, meeting regularly, pressuring people, putting the pressure on the division chiefs, to start making the change to get these things done, to move it from red to yellow to green to get achievement. If we meet the red turns to green in those red areas, that we meet those goals in the orange, it'll complete that blue line, and if we can get that done all the way around this Coggle in 3 years, we can be world class. That's how we're going to make the statement. And it's a different way of strategic planning. It's performance-based, but it's driving metrics, and it's the way we manage the strategic plan that's going to be different. The reason this is important, because strategic plans are used for a few things, right? They're used to demonstrate progress, to get us to move from where we're at today to something different, something unique, make us go somewhere. They're also there to drive efficiency. But the reason it's important today at a budget meeting, they're also there to control costs over time. And if you don't have a strategic plan that you're confident in, that's driving, that's actually working daily for you, you can't control costs over long periods of time. You'll be sitting in a budget meeting with a budget item to go forward with you today that we received 2, 3, 4 months ago, somewhat of a scramble to put something together to meet a short-term need. We're trying to move into more strategic planning so we can control our costs going forward. We know the population is going to increase. We've historically, in Portland, as a fire bureau, staffed based on as calls go up, we just keep taking on more calls. No questions asked. We'll just add more units, add more stations, add more people, keep running calls. More calls, more calls, more calls. And at some point, common sense would tell us all, how long can you keep that up? How long can you financially continue to pay for that? Over the past 60 years, the fire service has grown quite quickly. It's been quite expensive, I would assume. There's a smirk on Mr. Scott's face. Can we afford to continue this same way we're doing business the next 60 years? The answer is no. Cannot fiscally, financially be able to do that. So that's the reason we believe the strategic plan is important, that we can work together over time, control our costs, but still achieve those efficiencies that make us world class. Mark, I don't know where you're at, if you could advance the slide one. I think I have somebody on the slide set. Oh, very good. It's you, Jay. I didn't know that. So I paid Jay a lot of money for this. He's already making a mistake. Real quick, I know that as you're looking at this, you're probably wondering, what does the detail look like? This is just an example of what zero cancer deaths area looks like. There are multiple ones of these areas. For instance, when we talked about how does this align with the budget, we want to get to zero cancer deaths in the fire service.
Do we know how many we have now?
I would have to get those numbers for you.
Because I'm just... with this example that you've given to us, that's not realistic that firefighters would be somehow immune to all the cancers that you or I might get. Do we know how many of our firefighters smoke? Do we know how many of them drink alcohol? And are you planning to do something about that?
Yes, so it's a great segue. So for years, it's been heart failure and cardiac issues that have driven the high cost of health consequences in the fire service and also the death rate. Cancer is slowly taking that over as a national indicator of what firefighter death is coming to. It's now cancers are equal to that and taking over. If we don't do anything, then we just allow it to occur. I recommend we start putting a cancer reduction plan in place and start taking control of it here. Now, you're correct. Have to identify the number of individuals that have cancer. What kind of cancers are they dying from? Of those kinds that they're dying from, what are the general causes for that? We know that it, based on national issues, that it's all of the toxins that they're being exposed to during fires. We know that in even our own homes, the toxic substances and the things that we use to clean our homes with. We have firefighters living in these homes today. These are fire stations, right? Diesel exhaust accumulation, washing their turnouts. These are steps that we know as a national industry that we must take to reduce cancer deaths. So this is just one example of the larger scale and how we think we can achieve this, just one example.
So perhaps a more realistic goal would be for firefighter cancers to match the general population. I mean, it certainly sounds good to say zero, and of course we'd all like to eliminate cancer from our entire population. I would hope, I haven't looked in detail at the other ones, but I would hope that there are really realistic goals, because that's, otherwise you're setting up expectations which aren't possible.
I appreciate that concern. That I'll give you an example. In fact, if we can do the next slide, I'll show you one that would align with your comments. So we're rolling out a campaign today, and this, you're the first to see it, and that Zero is our hero. So in the middle of this a picture is our friend Nil. Nil stands for Zero, and Nil is going to take us through the next few years of achievement in the next 3 years, and there are some big critical goals that you see here that have been gleaned off the strategic plan to my right. So I've taken these off. These are ones that I think are very big, that are very important for you to know and very important for the community to know. And in relation to Commissioner Fritz's comments, because I think this is important what she says, the first one on the top left is zero fire deaths. Someone might say, that's, Chief, that's a very unrealistic goal. We could have a more realistic goal of maybe 3 or 4 fire deaths a year. But the goal is going to be zero. Can we achieve it in 3 years? The answer is yes. I've been in an organization this large where we were able to get to almost 500 days of zero fire deaths. It can be done. There's a way you have to do it. I know these goals are bold. We may not hit them all, but I am committed to giving every possible attempt to meet those goals. So I know we can get to zero fire deaths. There's a way we have to do it. It's in every detail thing we do. For instance, when we talk about internet connectivity, we don't have high-speed internet in the fire stations. A lot of our firefighters, we don't have an email in our fire stations. So when we have high-speed internet, I can then communicate with the fire station and train them on the computer and leave them in the station, not bring them out of the station across town in large groups and take them out of the run area. I can actually do it online in the firehouse, leaving them there in their area, a very inexpensive way to train it, right? And so they can have the readiness to respond in their area. That's why we have them there. That's why we put the fire station there to begin with. So these are small connections. The bottom one on the left, zero firefighter casualties. Very, very difficult to reach. A lot of luck goes into this one. But the bottom line is I committed it. I committed it to the spouses, to the families, to these firefighters, that I would send them home tomorrow. The performance measure is zero days in the emergency room, visits to the emergency room that lead to an overnight stay. I don't want those. How do we get there? A lot of training, good command presence, smart decisions on the fire ground, and some luck along the way. But I know we can do these things. It is also the start of a change of culture here within the organization. We've had a very good performance so far in this area. We have to keep it that way. The bottom one on the right, zero traffic deaths, is an interesting one. Commissioner Saltzman now has the Bureau of Transportation and also the Bureau, Fire Bureau, under his watch. Along the way today, as we discuss different topics, and this will, I just listened to Chief Marshman's presentation, it appears he's going through the same thing, which is appropriate. Today's issues are so complex that there is not one organizational solution that can actually fix the problems any longer. They are so complex that you must have partners, public partners, private partners, other bureau partners, or you will not fix the issue. So later on, we'll just look down at the box. Partnership is one of the key cornerstones for us. We must build partners with other bureaus, not only to help them reach their goals, but for them to help us reach our goals, which are our goals as a city. Zero traffic deaths is a Vision Zero Portland Bureau of Transportation primary goal. It is my absolute goal as well, as I commit to you as your fire chief to make sure we have health and wellness for our residents. The top one on the right is the most critical one. It's the most interesting one. And that is called Zero Neighbors Neglected. And we thought about this term, neglected. Is it the right term? We're neighbors. We have, I would say, from a public health standpoint, we have 30 brick and mortar buildings as a city that sit in neighborhoods today with 700 people out there capable of doing great work. They do it every day, firefighters, public health individuals. And I'll talk about how I think we can do some interesting things in the neighborhoods. So down at the bottom, real quick, I'm going to cover this, then I'll get into the next topic. Partner, advocate, protect, and advance. So the partner part, kind of just talked about that. We have to be able to break down those silos with other bureaus within the organization to really build those partnerships and capitalize on each other's resources, capitalize on each other's benefits, strengths. The advocate part and the neighbors neglected is an interesting thing. We want to champion diversity and equity by ending disparities in the workplace and strengthening community outreach. In each neighbors neglected, I'm going to explain that part where equity is a prime driver in this. If we look at health disparities, protect, I thought this was extremely interesting. I believe we're almost already here, that we can take measures to make Portland one of the safest cities our size in the country through response reliability and decreasing mortality. I know we can do this, and if we can set the right performance measures, and I will need help setting those performance measures, but what an interesting goal that would be. And the last one is, this is a big jump for us, but if we can't do it here at Portland Fire, it's going to be a hard stretch for anybody. We want to be the United States' most sustainable fire department in the country, and I think we can do it. So that's Mr. Zero is our hero, Neil. I think Neil's going to be an interesting campaign for us to take us into the future.
Can you explain in this paragraph, or maybe you're going to go into it a bit, you said we are developing specific plans called blueprints for success in each neighborhood. How are you engaging the community in developing those plans?
Great question. Next slide, please. You are right with us. So I don't know if I have a there's also, I'm sorry, these are to your back. I apologize. The room setup is not conducive for this. So we have an interesting layout here in Portland. And as you can see, the black dots on there are fire stations. Those are where the fire stations are located. Those geo-fenced areas that you see are what we call fire management areas. Within those fire, if you overlaid neighborhoods over these fire management areas, they would mix in there quite nicely. So what we've been doing up to this point is, and I'll just give you an example. We have a prevention effort. We might put a prevention effort out there that's for the whole of Portland. Well, Portland itself is very diverse. Every neighborhood is unique. For instance, up at Station 27 in the Forest Hills area, they have a different fire problem up there than they do down in East Portland. Agreed? Up in Station 27 in Forest Hills area, do they not have a different public health issues they're facing up at Station 27's area in their fire management area than we're facing down in East Portland? But we treat all of Portland the same from a fire bureau standpoint. We would like to take out the fire management area, just pluck one out, fillet it open, look inside, what is the fire problem that's unique to that fire management area? What is the traffic issues that are unique to that traffic area, that area? What are the top two, three public health issues facing that fire management area? And develop a blueprint for success to start fixing them. Can we as a bureau do it alone? Absolutely not. It's going to take a cross-section of public-private partnerships. It's going to take heavy investment in the neighborhoods. You will ask at some point, why does the fire chief care about sidewalks? Why does the fire chief care about healthy foods and grocery stores that is accessible by the public? Why does the fire chief care about jobs, homelessness, housing? Because if we don't have fair housing, if we can't help with the homeless problem, if we can't make sure that individuals have access to education, access to health care, access to healthy foods, safe, walkable streets, individuals, those FMAs will be largely at some point unhealthy. Unhealthy individuals will fall into our lap, and we will put product on the street to help them. We must get out in front. We must start upstreaming health care, and it's going to take partnerships with PSU, with OSHU, with urban planning at PSU, with the Multnomah County Public Health, a host of individuals coming to the tables, all of our partners in the 211 network, but each FMA is going to be different. So a large part of the future of public health for a city will probably be from our, we want to take the leadership role here, but it's going to be bringing people together. It's the partnerships that are going to make the difference. It's not all going to be about funding the fire department. It will be about funding BOIC. It will be about funding the police department on some of those unique things that they do in the community. And it will be about portions of funding the department. But it's a global view for the city. That's what I want to offer today. I've asked Bobby and Glenn to join us because I want them to specifically talk about the things that they learned in our budget that we're addressing some of the issues for both what we were telling you we could cut and the things that we were asking to back. So, Bobby.
Thank you. Mayor Wood, Commissioner.
Bobby, turn on the mic.
How's that?
Perfect.
All right.
Good morning.
Good morning, Mayor Wheeler, Fire Commissioner Saltzman, Commissioner Fritz. I'm Bobby Regan, a former longtime member of the Portland School Board and a member of the Fire Bureau's Budget Advisory Committee. It's been an honor to serve in this role now for the past 4 years and to work with two great fire chiefs. When I testified last year, the top priority of the Fire Bureau's Budget Advisory Committee was to keep the Fire Bureau whole by funding 13 firefighter positions that were then funded by a federal grant. I am grateful that the city stepped up, and thank you. This year, the Budget Advisory Committee continues to have deep concerns about possible budget cuts to the Fire Bureau's budget. That's because the city's population is dramatically growing. We are experiencing increased density with new multi-story buildings cropping up everywhere. Traffic congestion is real and worsening. The Bureau continues to be a first responder to the homeless and the most needy in our community, and we await a major earthquake. That makes fighting fires and responding to medical emergencies in Portland more complex than ever before. The Fire Bureau's response time is currently almost 2 minutes longer on average than its goal. 2 minutes longer than its goal. Since the ability to resuscitate a person decreases 10% with every passing minute, status quo could mean the difference between life and death. Yet here, we are focusing on possible cuts rather than possible adds. Our committee was asked to come up with a 2% reduction in the Fire Bureau's budget, and we did. That doesn't mean we support such cuts. In particular, with a river running through Portland, dismantling the Portland's Bureau dive team for a savings of just $94,000 seems short-sighted. I understand that eliminating our dive team in Portland will also cause the elimination of the dive team in Gresham, since it's a partnership activity. I also want to mention that reducing the capacity of the Bureau's rapid response vehicles, which effectively respond to low acuity calls, will also lead to even longer response times. I want to call out two things in our report that caught me by surprise this year. First, approximately 10,000 calls to 911 in Portland each year are generated by 100 people. I hope the city will look seriously at these frequent 911 callers to see if there might be a more efficient and more compassionate way of responding, freeing resources for true emergencies. Second, I hope you will especially consider the one-time ad requested for an additional set of turnouts for each of our Portland firefighters, as we believe this could allow for more frequent cleaning and ultimately reduce incidents of cancer for our firefighters. We expect our firefighters to put themselves at risk for us every day. That risk should not include the necessity to rewear clothing and boots that have been exposed to chemicals, asbestos, and other hazards. So I appreciate the difficult task you have of balancing the city's budget. I greatly appreciate this opportunity to testify. Thank you.
And to your comments about looking into the frequent users of 911, that's something that I started when I was first in charge of BOAC, and definitely I'm very interested in looking at it again.
It's definitely a multi-department effort.
Thank you, Bobby. Mayor, Commissioner, thank you, and Chief, for the opportunity to speak to you today. My name is Glenn Devitt. I'm a neighborhood emergency team volunteer and also served on the Budget Advisory Committee. I lead the neighborhood emergency team in Sunnyside. I think I have a different, interesting perspective. This is my first time on the BAC, so I learned quite a bit and was quite impressed with the talent brought to bear by all the participants. And the staff is amazing, of course, as you know. So I think I'd like to be very narrow. I fully endorse what Bobby has conveyed to you as far as the BAC's perspective, and no need to reiterate that. I think you get it. My perspective as a citizen and a volunteer through the NET program has been a concern about interagency cooperation, and I think that's really improving within the last year or two that I've seen between PBEM, ONI, BOAC, and Fire and Rescue. That's been the siloing, as the chief's word, of the budget process that causes these departments and bureaus to compete is troubling to me as a citizen. I realize it has to be done, but I also see and have seen at the staff level extraordinary cooperation outside beyond requirements that are imposed by leadership. Lieutenant Picard, who cooperates with PBEM and helps us train NETS, is extraordinary. Jeremy Van Curen, of course. And what we get out of these cooperations is neighborhood resiliency and community strength. A lot of what we do as NETS is not just the training for emergencies, but it's really for building community. Funny anecdote, last year my neighbors for our block party said, let's have a theme around emergency preparedness. And I said, you're crazy, nobody's going to come. 60 people came and stayed all day, and the fire department came and brought the engine. So it's those building those bonds and strength and community that's tremendously important. And I think the chief's plan I admire quite a bit. So I thank you for the opportunity to share that with you.
Thank you, and that's a great idea for a themed party. Fantastic. I hope other people replicate that.
When I was in charge of ONI, we had some discussions, and I was hoping to be able to partner much more closely with fire and emergency management, because we need to, for one thing, we need to get away from talking about crime prevention in the community system. And secondly, I think people are much more aware that they need to plan for the big one, in some cases more than they have to be afraid of who's living next door to them.
I would add to that we're actually working with Mark Wells in ONI, coordinating with the Crime Prevention, Crime Watch, and NET, because they're similar constituencies. The mindset is there for community strength and resilience. So.
Rob?
Thank you. So in October of 2016, of last year, a boat capsized in San Francisco, and their dive team rescued more than 10 people or something like that. I was just wondering if the city council were to adopt these cuts and there were a capsize of, say, one of the ferries or boats in the, not a ferry, but a boat in the Willamette, is the expectation that the county would address it, or would everybody just drown?
It's we know we sit on, 80 square miles of waterway, is my understanding. We're right in the middle of the Willamette and Columbia. We are a water-based city. This municipal, this city is water-based, and we're obviously, the Willamette is very important to us. The people are participating in the Willamette every day, rowers and boaters, and people are in the Willamette now swimming, and things like that will probably only increase. And if you remember back in the summer, I was only here for a couple months, and I have to give Dan a call whenever we lose somebody. And I don't like those calls, Dan, right? And you and I have talked about, I don't want to make those calls to you. And we had to make the call at Kelly Point drowning. Things happen in these waterways. And it's my responsibility as your fire chief and as your risk manager, basically, to tell you what I think we should do and what we shouldn't do. We do a tremendous, I would say, it was probably one of the things I was surprised with most coming from the desert before I got here. I didn't realize how many surface rescues our fire department conducts every day. And they're out there on that water all the time with boats and watercraft and people in the water regularly rescuing people. People are jumping from bridges, and it's just, you may not see it in the community. I see it every day because I watch, it comes across my phone every day, 24 hours a day. It's going on regularly. So when it came down to the dive team, I had to make a decision. And I'm also responsible to protect those firefighters. And the way I understood the dive team, and this is not unusual across the country for cities that sit on water, is my understanding, as I've done as much study as I can do, that the way we've been staffing to this point, and you'll notice in the budget request, it's either an add or a takeaway. And how I expressed it to Commissioner Saltzman was, look, Dan, we either need to do this or we don't. We manage a ton of high risk, very low frequency events in the fire service. We run 80,000 calls a year. The majority of those are medical. They're gunshots, car rollovers, cardiac arrests, strokes, hangings, high-risk pregnancies, everything you can imagine we run on. A large proportion of these are fires. This community, we fight a lot of fire in Portland. Some of those other calls that fill in the gaps are what I call high-risk, low-frequency, those calls on a tank car or a hazmat call or a person's trapped or they fell off some big high rig and we have to rig a rope system, rescue them. We don't do that a lot. We don't have a lot of those calls. But when people call and everybody's looking around, who's going to like take care of these people? Who's going to rescue this person? The fire department says, we will. And then I put a 24-year-old out there with three other 24-year-olds, and I give them a bunch of tools, and I tell them, figure it out, and don't get hurt, and rescue these people. And they have to think. And they work with what they have. And I give them what I think I can give them, and then I try to go to sleep at night knowing they're not going to get injured. And the dive team's a similar situation. It's high risk, low frequency. This year when I ran the data, I thought, I can't go to the commission with this data. There's four or five times you were in the water.
How many of those are rescued alive by the dive team?
Zero this
year.
So right? So, but here's the situation. I had the same conversation, Commissioner. The same question. Like, what's the chances of survival if we put the divers in the water? And the same conversations came up. Chief, it's not about how many we rescued alive this year. The half of the time, the dive team was down because we didn't have the numbers to staff it. But
over the last 5 years, though, how many is the dive team rescued alive?
Zero is my understanding. Yeah. It's a body recovery largely. The stories I get are, Chief, we have it's a high-risk adventure. We can either stand there and wait, but the time's going to come when we put the divers in the water, their body recoveries. The time's going to come when we're going to stand there and we're not going to have the dive team. And Chief, you're going to own this. We're going to stand there and not go in. Is that what the community wants? My recommendation as your risk manager is we're a community on the water. We should have a dive team so we can be prepared. If we don't, and if we select today or whenever we decide that we don't want to do it as a group here, we don't want to have the dive team, I just go back to the emotion that I had after Kelly Point thinking, I went to Dan and said, Dan, we're either going to staff this thing or not, and that's why today it's on the table for if we staff it, it's an extra 90-something thousand. If we don't, we can save 80-something.
Doesn't the sheriff's office do body recovery?
They do body recovery. They come in, my understanding is a half hour, an hour and a half after they're called in. We will stand there and wait for them. We will not leave the scene. We will stand there with the public, and we will wait for the dive team to come in to do the body recovery. The question is, do we want to wait that time on the shore as a city of Portland and wait for the county to come in and dive the river?
So here's a great example of where having siloed government in our community confounds us. The city and the county, and I believe there are other waterway enforcement agencies, the Coast Guard is out there somewhere.
Correct.
What I've really been encouraging for a long time for all of the first responder and public safety bureaus to do is get together and create a unified plan, because we've got two major riverways that go through multiple jurisdictions, two different states. There's federal ownership, there is state ownership, there is regional ownership, there is local ownership, and we're all budgeting these individual programs in a black box. You mentioned, for example, this dive team isn't just Portland's dive team. It skips three jurisdictions and then reconnects at Gresham. And I'm trying to figure out, okay, well, where does the county's dive team come in? Because we always have this debate about river patrol. Is it fire? Is it the county sheriff's river patrol? Is it some combination of both? And as you know, there's a lot of territorial interest in these particular service models. So I guess as I evaluate this, I totally buy your insurance argument, by the way. It's a very compelling argument. On the other hand, the question is how many other jurisdictional leaders are hearing exactly the same argument? So I can almost guarantee you the county commissioners, as they do, they're going to hear exactly the same argument.
I would agree, Mayor.
And so the question is, why don't we just have a unified dive team? And then we're coordinated. And then that makes it easier for us to coordinate with Gresham, Wood Village, Troutdale, and whoever else I'm forgetting. State of Washington, right. I mean,
Vancouver.
Vancouver's probably in Clark County are having the same conversation on the other side of the river, right. So there's an opportunity, Pam, go for it. Solve the problem for us.
Mayor Wheeler, I couldn't agree with you more. And what I would advocate for is this $94,000. It's $94,000, people. We're not talking about staff people here. We're talking about training, premium pay. That's all we're talking about here to keep our dive team, $94,000. What I would advocate for is keep that in the budget this year and tell the chief to start having that conversation. But to have that conversation after you've eliminated our dive team puts him in a completely different position. So keep it for a year, ask him to come back in a year and report on what these conversations are, but let's not lose the momentum by not having the firefighters trained up and equipped to be able to do this work for the during that period.
Yeah, and that's a great suggestion. I like the strategy, and I want to acknowledge again, you know, the chief is fairly new here, so we're talking. You know, this is a debate, Pam. You and I have been involved in for a long, long time, and the poor chief is just getting his first exposure to it. That being said, this is what I expect the chief to do. We have various public safety entities where we communicate and collaborate on a regional basis, and I am hoping that we start rationalizing not only our budgeting process but the delivery model as well. So I think that's a very compelling suggestion. It's low cost. I like the chief's description of this as an insurance policy. I just want to make sure the same insurance salesman isn't knocking on every door in town and selling exactly the same insurance policy five times over. That's all I'm worried about.
Yep. And I would just rather have him negotiate from a position of strength rather than having already eliminated and kind of begging everybody else to step up. So that's all I would say.
Well, except that when we did have this discussion back in 2009, the then fire commissioner would not refuse to entertain the possibility of eliminating our dive team. I do have just one follow-up conversation question for the chief. What's the response time of the dive team?
I'm going to ask Chief Williams to come up. So, sorry, Tom, I know you were just here. So Chief Williams is a newly appointed operations chief. He comes highly recommended from staff members from around the area when I made a selection for the operations chief. So I'm going to introduce you to Division Chief Tom Williams, who is over operations. The dive team rests under his control and special operations.
Good morning. Thank you.
Morning and congratulations.
Yeah, thank you. To answer a couple of your questions, we do work closely with Multnomah County Sheriff. Historically, we have the personnel in the right places and the quick response times for our engines getting our dive members to a scene. Multnomah County Sheriff, as you know, is split out throughout the county, so they might have the appropriate personnel on, but it takes them quite a bit longer to get their resources to the location. So anytime we can get divers to that location quicker, we increase our success rate for survival. Even though, great question, in fiscal years 2009 to 13, we had 55 actual responses. And of those 55 responses, we actually got in the water 15 times, and we pulled eight victims out of the water. But those were eight people, or 15 people, that actually had a better chance at survival versus us waiting. And the way we operate is that the first 60 minutes is what we call rescue mode. So within 60 minutes, and obviously it depends on water temperature, but mostly within that 60 minutes, if we can get to somebody, they have a really good chance at survival. After that, it's called recovery mode, and that's usually about the time that Multnomah County Sheriff arrives. So our statistics on actual response times aren't incredibly accurate because they're based on our dive van. So all of our members have their dive equipment at the fire stations. But to answer that question, it's about 26 minutes. But that, again, it's not accurate because divers on fire engines are getting to the scene faster. The dive van is not something that's staffed, so it's cross-staffed by a fire engine currently in North Portland. So if that engine's out, they have to go back to the scene, pick the van up, and move. If we have the appropriate amount of divers on scene at the right time, they can actually get in the water much sooner than that.
Thank you. Tom, you've been waiting. And then let me get Tom in, and then we'll get you in, okay?
Great. Thanks, Mayor. Chief, as you know from our previous conversations, I find your strategic plan inspiring, and I'm stealing from it shamelessly, so thank you for that. My question is on this, what I would call major cultural change on the zero neighbors neglected section. I want to hear a little bit more about how this budget is going to further your work with what I would describe as a very ambitious vision for getting people in the community and other local governments seeing the fire bureau differently. Mm-hmm. And wondering if you could educate us a little bit more on how this budget process and your strategic plan is gonna springboard you into what I would describe as a pretty resource intensive effort on this zero neighbors neglected vision. Could you talk about that a little bit?
I can. So this resulted from the fire, zero fire deaths approach that I used in a different location that I was a fire chief in, and to some success. So the zero neighbors neglected idea, the theme behind that, and I'll just kind of maybe tap on something that's probably near and dear to everyone's heart here, so I'm not trying to pull heartstrings, it's just a good example. Mental health, if you look at this particular FMA that we sit in right here today, I would argue, and I have not seen the health assessment from the county for what actually goes on in this fire management area. They're working on that right now, and that's part of building this blueprint for success. But I would argue that it's probably mental health, maybe drug addiction, homelessness. I would imagine those are probably amongst the top few. To address those, one would argue that's not a fire service perspective, right? It's what does the fire service have to do with those three things? But we know that when a call comes in for an individual with drug addiction, mental health, or homelessness that is yielding some other medical type concern, that putting a 24-year-old paramedic with a defibrillator out there to talk to the patient, to then put them into an ambulance for whatever the dollar amount that's going to be, to take them to the emergency room, to the back door of the emergency room, to get whatever care they're going to get to the emergency room, and then release them out the other side, was not the care that the individual needed. That's could a small illustration of why we're in the healthcare position we're in today. So with that theme, and plus the fact that we're not getting any help from the feds, the government's not here to help with mental health in the United States of America. The state can't do it. The county's trying, and they need help. Where do these people fall? Into our lap. And when it's a health-related issue, whose lap do they fall into? Your safety net. Who's your safety net? It's your fire department. If we're going to get ahead of the public health issue, or we can be reactive and stay reactive. I can keep fuel in the fire trucks, wheels on the fire truck, and I can make sure that Tom has the staff he needs every day, and we can run your typical municipal fire department across the country. Easy piece of cake. In fact, you don't need me. Hire any fire chief you want. Easy. But if we're going to do something different in Portland, and I think we have the potential right here at this table to do something unique. I've met these bureau directors. They're sharp. I know what you want to do. I know, I can feel it, I can tell, and we've got sharp people here. I've got 700 employees that are ready to go in 30 public health buildings out there, ready to go. And it is not going to be us, it's not your fire department's gonna solve this issue, I'm not saying that. But it can be us to stand up and be bold. It can be us to set bold goals that I'm going to put my neck out on. It can be us to be serious and drive this to show muscle and support and start bringing people together. In the end, in a year, 2 years, Chief, you failed. Maybe. But what if we didn't? What if we didn't fail? What if we were able to bring people together and do a blueprint for success for one FMA? For one FMA that actually identified the performance measures for the health assessment we wanted to change, and we were actually able to change them, and it was because we had 30 firefighters working there, fire prevention people working there, people from PSU working there, OSHU working there. There are people already doing similar things like this already. This is not new stuff, but it's about bringing all the right people together. And it's about us taking bold steps to jump on board. So the items that are on the ask list today, where we draw the equation from what does the budget have to do with the idea behind zero neighborhoods neglected, it's why we have public health positions on the budget request. That's why there's a public health coordinator to coordinate this activity to kickstart this. And that's why we're doing things like CHAT, the CHAT program to redefine the right locations for these individuals to go. It's not necessarily the emergency room. We are here to tailor the response for these patients, for the FMA, and tailor the way we do prevention in the fire management area. We may not be sending them to the emergency room. It may not be an ambulance that goes to the call. It may be some public health group that goes in this FMA. In the other FMA, it might be something different. It may be BOIC being funded to the point where they can take a call in, make a decision, and that with that patient's call never even goes to an ambulance or an engine company the way it's always been done. It goes to some other public health group. or it goes to some carrier that does something telephonically and is able to get care there a different way. That's the future. Tom comes back from the training center the other day. He said, Chief, I just want to tell you, I'm super excited to tell you I welcomed 15 new individuals into the fire department today. Thanks, Tom. And Chief, by the way, they'll be retiring in 2047. And walks out. It's 2047. 2047, they're going to retire 30 years from now. What is this department and this organization going to look like in 2047? It better not look like it is today. And right now, what's facing me, what I'm, why the reason that I'm here asking for public health individuals to help me kickstart this thing, is the bottom line is the public health is the threat. Mm-hmm. It's what's happening to us, and we're not alone. And up and down the West Coast, we know Frisco, San Francisco, Seattle. It's everywhere, and if you go back east, it's there too. So, if that sums up the.
Yeah, thanks. Can I do one quick follow-up, Mayor?
Yeah, and then I want to get to Nechka.
So, when I know that some nonprofit organizations over the years have made agreements with local hospitals on the frequent users of the emergency rooms in terms of diversion programs. Has the Bureau considered approaching the hospitals about the CHAP program or the first community health coordinators? Because it's in their interest to keep people out of the emergency rooms, as it's in all of our interests. Just wondering if that step's been made.
You know, it's I have the luxury of having a very good staff, and that's one of the benefits that I have, and I lean on them heavily. And Division Chief Ken Burns has actually was starting to work on this before I even got here, right? I'd love to take credit for everything, but it's not the fact. So, Ken, can you answer Tom's questions regarding community health coordinator and CHAT?
Well, I can. Yeah. Thank you for bringing that up. Most of you probably remember that the mayor and commissioners. Were helpful in putting a CHAT. CHAT is the Community Healthcare Assessment Team. It's basically a six-month pilot where we partnered with Multnomah County to look at the high utilizers of the 911 system. And in that system, we took 20 of the most highest utilizers. There's actually currently a list of about 400. And to get on that list, that's 10 or more calls in 6 months or three or more in 1 month period. But just talking about the CHAT in our pilot program, we reduced those 20 individuals from calling 911 from 274 calls over a six-month period to 69. And that's, ambulance, most of you probably know also, that's $1,000. And ER visits, about $2,000. My quick math showed that we, although the Portland Fire and Rescue did not gain any revenue, we saved the healthcare system $600,000+ over that six-month period. One of the asks in the budget is to continue that program with the community healthcare assessment team. That is one position that is on the table to be discussed. The second position that we're asking for is a community healthcare coordinator, and that is a program that actually is slated to be a contractual agreement with the hospital to take on those individuals who are at high risk for readmissions. That's a generation of some revenue, some offset, that has the potential of $50,000 revenue over a six-month period, and that's a partnership with Good Sam Hospital. We do have the potential to increase that to other hospitals. At the same time, that individual, that position that we're seeking funding for, will be instrumental in going into the FMAs, looking for clinic availability, different type of shelters, and really connecting the fire stations with the community. So those two positions that we are asking for are really about zero neighbors neglected.
Very helpful. Just a time check, 10 minutes. Dinechka, you've been waiting patiently. Thank you.
No, quickly, as a follow-up with the dive team issue, is the county's response after 60 minutes because they only do recovery or because they always get there after 60 minutes?
Yeah, and I don't want to make it sound like they're consistently at 60 minutes. There's times when they're quicker than that, but that's on average when they can get a crew together and respond to the scene.
But it's not because they only do recovery.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah, correct. And Mr. Mayor, quite frankly, I am the insurance guy knocking on Gresham's door because we actually, with the limit of ours, our presentation to you today is a reduction in what we had as a full team, and I have asked them to boost their membership in the program. We respond together.
Very good. I appreciate that, and that will flag me as well to talk to the mayor of Gresham about this. So thank you for that. I appreciate it.
I'd like to.
Yes, please. Frieda and then Rob.
back on your coordinator position, if I understood right, you're really going to contract with Legacy?
We will contract with multiple hospitals. So there's an opportunity today in the healthcare market. Hospitals are under, and realize, let me preface everything, not knowing where healthcare is going to go with the new administration. Currently, hospitals can contract with outside providers to keep readmission down, and they have an interest in when they discharge a patient, that patient in a certain time period is not readmitted back to the hospital. It's a performance measure for them, and there's some financial benefit for them to lower readmissions. They contract out for that service. Now, they'll contract with different parties. We have an opportunity as a city to contract with them as well. The reason I think it's good business practice for us to do so, it is a modern business practice, it is different. The reason I believe it's good business practice is these are our neighbors and individuals that are actually live in our area in the with around where those firehouses are. And it's an opportunity for us to visit them, be with them, start to talk to our neighbors and actually get to know them and actually slow down readmissions back into the hospital and do it under a contract format where we can offset the cost of the very employee that we're asking for.
Well, I'm in regard to the hospitals. So are they putting in a certain portion of funding toward this? Because I know many of our hospitals are nonprofit or not for profit, and they're required to put so much money into the community. And I'm wondering if they're partnering with you and picking up, they're going to have, excuse me, considerable savings. So are they picking up and putting money into the program also? Because I think people don't realize they were in a lot of trouble several years ago with the IRS because they weren't putting money into the communities. And now they're required or they lose their standing.
Yeah, I think there's several motivations. Readmissions is one thing and the potential loss of revenue for the hospitals. But the current contract that's on the table for us, a great opportunity, is based on, and the funding source is based on 20 individuals who have either congestive heart failure or diabetes or a selected group that have a high rate of readmissions. And they're also based on 4 home visits within the first 21 days of readmission. So that funding of the $24,000 quarterly or $100,000 annually is actually being paid from the hospital to Portland Fire and Rescue. That's the opportunity. That's their funding that they're putting towards our effort to take care of basically all of our citizens. And quite frankly, some of these folks would be calling 911 at 3 o'clock in the morning and going back through the ER. And so the readmissions and this healthcare readmissions program will link up daytime visits with their primary care provider, which is the best way to provide care for them.
Okay, thank you, because I wanted to make sure they were putting a little funding in there also. In regard to chat, what your last statement or the CBO's office on page 6 is due to resource limitations, the county, they do not have the capacity to address demand, shifting the work to the fire department. I've had recent meetings with commissioners there, and they keep stating health is their primary and seniors are their primary. Given if this is funded, are you going to push back so that the county picks up their share? Because I really think they should.
Yeah, when you look at our community, there's a substantial social needs out there. Mm-hmm. Multnomah County is doing a fantastic job. Like I said, they have over 400 high utilizers, and we are we are looking at the top 20 and 30. And it's not the same 30. Our idea and the concept that we've actually proven is we actually do a soft handoff to the appropriate agency when time's ready. So we're really looking at 100 people over a year's time, but just 20 at a time, so we can give them the services and direct them to the proper services instead of calling 911. This program's also set up to take some workload off the fire engines and fire stations also, because those who are calling 911, that's their that's their way of getting health care. And the chat program, the individual actually goes to that individual's house 3 or 4 days later to talk about using 911, to talk about their insurance and how they can utilize their insurance. So it really is redirecting them. Mm-hmm. But we will always partner with the hospitals, the CCOs, and Multnomah County. It's a group effort.
So my question is actually about this same kind of thing.
Right.
which is so I was wondering about the CBO's characterization that without significantly expanding this model, this program is unlikely to have meaningful impact on call volume. Because it sounds like there's already kind of meaningful impact on call volume, and rather than just being 20 people, it's actually 100 people since they're rotating through it. And so, I mean, we know that, 65% of Portland Fire and Rescue calls are health-related and not fire. So, I mean, this is the area of the greatest sort of response that we see from fire and rescue, and a lot of that, as we've discussed in years past, is due to these high-volume callers. And this is a program that actually sort of tries to reach out to those people and change their standard operating procedures. So I'm just wondering why CBO thinks that this is a good place to pass on investment when it looks like this has been a pretty successful program.
Sure, yeah, I can speak to that. My name is Ryan Kinsella, again, the analyst that works with Portland Fire and Rescue from the Budget Office. So the proposal that I think the part that you're referring to is related to the high utilizer program. Based on the proposal, the Bureau thought there would be about 500 calls that could be addressed to the addition of this one person. Next year, Portland Fire and Rescue is going to address probably 2,500 additional calls due to the increase in call volume. So to scale, you'd have to invest about five times this amount to have a meaningful impact on just next year's additional call volume. That doesn't like speak to the fact that the next year after that, we're going to have 25 additional new calls, which will require a certain amount of investment, and then again another investment in the third year and ongoing. So our primary concern was absolutely this is an effective program. It's been very meaningful in this particular area. Whether this is going to help them address the overall strategic problem with large increases in call volume, this is an example of it. It's not going to get them to a substantial impact on it over the next 5 years.
May I offer rebuttal?
Right.
So first of all, Ryan and I work very closely together, so this is good. This is good discussion. It's imperative that we, as a group, if the population continues to grow and we continue to operate the same way we always have, which is just continue to take on the call volume without any change in structure, then Ryan is correct. The call volume goes up. We continue to add expense and investment in just handling the calls. Then he is absolutely 100% correct. We must invest other ways to bring to temper that call volume and change that skew. That we have to manage the calls, not just take them on. The calls can go to different locations. We can't stick in the same way we've been for years and just give them to the fire department and they'll run them. And Myers will come here in another year and ask for another fire truck, right? That's not the way we do it in the future. The future is shifting. We must be able to manage the way that call. Not every call should have an engine company on it. Not every call should have a truck company on it. Some calls need just an ambulance. Some calls need an engine and a truck. When we have a cardiac arrest, you should see these crews work. They save lives out there. That when there's gunshots and there's rollovers and there's entrapments, you put everything on it. It's amazing. A lot of calls don't need that. A lot of calls just need an ambulance. Some calls don't need an ambulance or a fire truck. They need some community health partner that is undeveloped yet. If we avoid investment, and I understand where we're headed, and we'll be back next year, because I'll try to figure out a way to keep this going. But if we avoid investment, at some point, we can't ever kick it off. The initial kickoff is the hardest thing to do. It is always the hardest thing to do, because you're starting with very small numbers. We're looking at how we're going to largely control public health over time. But if we don't start tackling it, it's going to sit outside my window in 55 Ash, and I'm just going to watch it. And when it happens, somebody's going to call and send a fire truck across the street. And I feel obligated to stop doing that.
Thank you, Chief. Anybody else? Bobby and Glenn, thank you for being here today to share your insights. Chief, thank you. Great presentation. We
thank
appreciate
you.
It. Why don't we take a 5-minute break, just because I know we need to move the blood clots around, and we'll come back for the Bureau of Emergency Communications. Yep, please.
Okay.
Dive right in, and then people will ask questions as they come up. And folks, if you have questions, just raise your hand, and I'll write you down here on the list so I get to people in the proper order. Thank you.
Awesome. Good afternoon. As Commissioner Fritz said, my name is Lisa Turley, and I'm the current director of the Bureau of Emergency Communications. And with me is Operations Manager Lisa St. Helen, who will become the interim director beginning April 1st, and I'm really happy to be handing this over to her. It's been an amazing 15 years, but yeah.
That's a long time.
I am following the most dynamic public speaker I've seen in a while, and I'm just hoping that your lunch hunger will make this, ready to go here. So it's interesting following the police and fire bureaus because they are our customer. Whatever they're doing, we're gonna, and the reason we sit through the whole presentation is because whatever it is they have up their sleeves, we are going to have to do something about later, especially if you fund it. So it's nice to have a little heads up about, oh, they're thinking about this, great. Our mission is threefold. We answer 911 calls, we dispatch appropriate public safety response to those calls and track responder activities, and as time and resources allow, we answer non-emergency public safety calls. We perform these duties not just for the city of Portland, but for all of the jurisdictions within Multnomah County. And I would like to say right now that any kind of intergovernmental activities that you want to do in the public safety arena, look at the BOEC model. It really does work. We're already out there in the county. We're out there in Gresham. We know how to make these partnerships work. We do it all the time. Our IGA is a model that I would not suggest you copy, but I suggest that you you look at it as a guide for how you might do more of these activities on a more structured, legitimate method. Because of our very focused role as the Public Safety Emergency Triage Center for the county, we operate as a 24/7, 365 emergency coordination center. We are inherently a highly resilient operation, but at the current time, we are also operating at or near our maximum much of the time. We continue to be short-staffed, although the training opportunities that we're getting a lot of people through the door have really improved that situation looking forward. So walking you through the briefing documents that you've already received in your books, over the past year, we've seen a number of changes in our metrics. The first page is a blue graph like this, and it shows a dramatic increase in the number of 911 calls that wait more than 2 minutes before one of our call takers answers. This increase is due to a couple of factors. Working with our technology services partners, we are now able to capture more accurately the time calls spend connecting to the technology that's located at BOIC. This has added as much as 29 seconds to every wireless call that is received at BOIC. And considering that more than 70% of our calls currently are now wireless, that is a significant number of calls that might take a little bit longer to get into our system. Some changes in protocols, both law enforcement and medical, have seen a slight increase in handling time per call, and that contributes to longer handling times and longer waiting times for incoming callers. And finally, as you can see on the graph on page two, this was the 911 calls. This one is shows our current staffing, and you can see that we have more trainees on the floor and fewer certified staff. Although an increase in trainee numbers is a great thing, it does mean increased call handling times, since our new folks take slightly longer to process incidents than do the more experienced call takers. Page three shows the impacts of fewer staff managing higher call volumes. The number of calls handled per person per hour, not day, there's a typo on your handout, sorry. Yeah, they handle more than 12 and a half calls a day. There's a typo. So it grew at an alarming rate from 10.9 to 12 and a half. So that's a significant increase in call volumes. When you're considering that the people who are calling in could be calling in on the worst day of their lives, not always, but very often it is a very stressful situation that our call takers are dealing with, and so that's really a lot of asking them to do another one and a half calls a day, an hour, can really add up to their to the impact on them. And then finally, the final chart in the book shows our shift assignments through September. And although we do have less red blocks than we've had in past years, we have way too many yellow blocks, and that leaves us in a very precarious staffing situation for managing incoming calls. So as I've said in previous budget presentations over the years, there's only two ways that BOIC can address these issues, and this is where we get to the budget situation. The first is to increase our staffing, and we're on a good path for that to occur. We've hired many trainees, and we hope to continue to run three academies for the next 1 to 2 years to ensure that we get on top of the bubble and stay there. I think both Chief Marshman and Chief Meyer spoke to that, kind of getting up there and staying up there. It's critical for what we're doing. We can only do that if we have the funding. So we did submit the required decision packages for 2 1% cuts, and these will come out of our overtime budget. We will not be laying anyone off, but that can impact our training opportunities, and we hope that you can avoid having to take those cuts. More importantly, we have met the budget note requirement to conduct a staffing study. That's the handout that we just dropped on your desks while you're out. That is a 4-page synopsis of the 14-page draft report I just received. There is a lot of material in there, but on the bottom line is actually on page 4. And in that, it explains how they get there. Matrix Consulting Group is recommending that BOIC have a budget allocation for 118 certified dispatchers and call taker FTEs. That's up from the current 107. So that is an increase in staffing. It should be noted that Matrix in their documentation does not address the number of trainees that need to be in process, but we believe that having the authority to hire limited term positions for up to two academies per year with up to 10 trainees in each is sufficient. I will obviously provide Commissioner Fritz's office with the final version of the consultant report as soon as I have it. And with that information provided, we do request that the temporary funding that we have received for the current fiscal year be converted to permanent funding for the additional necessary positions. Kind of on a second note, I said there were two ways that BOA can address our call volume. The second way to improve, to address our call handling is to reduce our call load. Obviously, we're the only place that we can answer 911 calls, and we're the only place that can dispatch public safety responders. And other people, as Chief Meyer said, we can, if you give us a place to send our calls, the incidents, we can figure out how to get them there. But we have to have those places to drop callers, because right now all we have are police, fire, medical, and a small portion for mental health issues. Add to that, we'd be happy to handle those calls off. But my extreme interest in seeing a 311 call center at some point in Portland's future has to do with our call volumes. And we have a $500,000 request in our budget for a 311 project. So that's our budget. I would like to take a moment to thank one last time Gary and Jenny for their work preparing the budget, and to Commissioner Fritz for her leadership over the years, and all the staff at BOIC for their dedication, professionalism, and service. So that's the presentation.
Thank you. And I want to add my name to the long list of people who are very, very grateful for your service. And I can't even imagine over all those years that you've served how much of a difference you have made personally in the lives of thousands of people in this community. So thank you.
Thank you.
Questions? Could you lay out the 311 vision?
Sure.
What do we get for the 500 in
I think with that 500,000, what you get is that you kind of like what Chief Marshallman was talking about with the body cam issue, is you hire someone. We've already done a good study that shows about how it happens, but I think you start small. I think you it's an iterative project, and once you get it going, it's really pretty simple to roll bureaus and questions in. But you either purchase the software or you don't, because there's a way to do it using the current resources at BOAC, and actually starting at BOAC and getting a proof of concept, because many of the calls are already coming in, especially calls around transportation issues. And you create, you give your call takers, whoever they are, and I recommend that if you do start this at BOAC, you create a non-emergency call taker position, and it really focuses on customer service, because these are the people that are going to be able to spend a lot of time with a caller and really find out what the caller needs.
So, Director Turley, could I ask, are these the people who are going to start getting at what I'll call the high-frequency users, the 100 people who are calling in 100 times or more per year?
I think you could, because there are ways that basically when you go to a full-blown 311 system, city already has 211. It's a community nonprofit function, and it deals with social service issues. 911 deals with your emergency public safety calls. 311 deals with everything else. And so if you can train, I mean, people can get a three-digit number. And if you can figure out who your frequent callers are, and you tell them, you know what, don't call 911 anymore, call 311. And you give, the way that 311 works is the call taker has a script, an FAQ answering script, so you could put somebody's name in it, and they could say, I'm John Smith, and their call mask would come up, and you would be able to walk them through what the previous issues of John Smith have been. Mm-hmm. So you could deal with that person's issues, or you would have a call mask that says, my garbage cans didn't get collected, how do I deal with that?
Great, Rob, thank you.
Do you guys have a sense or maybe concrete data on what percentage of the calls that are already fielded through 911 are, or in your opinion, would most appropriately be funneled through 311? Are we talking about like 5% of the total volume, 10, 15, 20? Okay, yeah. I would love to know what your thoughts are on that.
I've been tracking that. I actually started my drive to 311 in 2006, and back then our call volume on our non-emergency line, because that's where I started, was at about 25%. Currently it's 35% of our call volume. So if you say that we're doing a million calls a year at BOEC, that's a lot of calls. And I can tell you professionally and personally that if there was a 311 system, BOEC would not need to have, we would not be where we are in our staffing crisis, because we would be right-sized to handle our 911 calls, dispatching. And there are some calls on our 311, because we answer 823-3333, that's our non-emergency line. Some of those calls on there have to come to us because they do require a public safety dispatch. So not all of those calls would go to 311, but 35% of our calls currently come in on our non-emergency line.
Lisa, with the longer hold times, are you finding that there are some people who are trying to up triage their calls from non-emergency to emergency in hopes of getting a quicker reaction? And if so, how do you deal with that?
I think we would both agree yes, and I'm going to let Lisa deal with that because she works with her folks every day.
Yeah, the answer without question is yes. And a lot of those people traditionally are going to be your repeat callers, the people that understand how to manipulate the system to get or to elicit the response that they're hoping to receive. We do have a triage guide, whether that be fire or medical, that our call takers do follow, and those are followed stringently, so that if a call does not meet the criteria for an emergency response, it does not receive an emergency response. A good example of that is somebody calling in and just wants a ride to the hospital. They want an ambulance. And their inability to express why they need that ambulance, we will be asking them triage guide questions to find out if there's any emergency symptoms. If there's no emergency symptoms, we may still send them the ambulance, but it won't be on an emergency basis.
Also, I just want to say the other day I was in South Waterfront and I observed something that was kind of out of the ordinary and got hot, and I dialed 911, spoke to one of your operators, complete professionalism, and they always ask you who you are at the end, so that's how we know that city commissioners don't get treated any differently, and just kudos to the people who you work with.
Thank you very much. They're an exceptional group of people.
Commissioner Fritz? Oh, I'm sorry, then Commissioner Saltzman.
Sure. So I know the answer to this, but if you could just explain to everybody else about the issue of are we dropping a lot of calls and not calling people back?
Right, I appreciate that. Yes, we did have, actually I'm gonna let Lisa do that because she worked 6 months on that project, and she's way more expert about it than I am.
So I will answer that by saying that the likelihood, or I'm not certain that I'm in complete agreement with the 18,000 calls that was quoted. I worked for a long time with the city ombudsman to try and go through that very technical process, which is what's called our XMU system. There still is a possibility. There are a small number of calls that do get dropped. It is a technological issue, and it's not an issue that we currently have control over. We are anticipating that that will eliminate, that problem will be eliminated when the new phone system that we are due to be receiving probably late this spring, early summertime. And I don't think I answered your full question.
Right, just the number of 18,000 drop calls was out there.
Yeah, that number is out there. The problem with that number is that you can't quantify it. You cannot quantify what you don't know. When people call 911 and they do not get a response, they do not get an answer, we do get complaints from those people, or at least inquiries from those people, and we investigate all of those to find out what happened. And sometimes there is a phone problem. Sometimes there's a cell phone carrier issue, and that can be tracked through our phone system itself. Through people that work specially with that system. But the 18,000, we have received nowhere near that number of complaints, so I am leery that that is a close estimate to what has actually been dropped.
So we think it's pocket dials, it's various other reasons.
So this, exactly. So it's called an XMU switch, and so it is set up so that when you call 911, if you intend to get through 911, it simply tells you, say something, make a sound, press a button, do anything, and it's set at a certain sensitivity that if any sound is heard, it pops you directly into our answering 911 queue. If nothing is heard for 12 to 15 seconds, then the call is disconnected. So that absolutely can happen. That is the intent of the XMU switch, and it saves thousands of calls a month from having our folks having to call back. The statement that people are calling and not receiving a call back is an inaccurate statement. Our policy states that when cell phones call in, if anything is heard on that other line, then our call takers do routinely call back, and that is something that we do monitor, we do look into and test or make sure that our folks are actually following that policy. So that does happen.
Yeah, I remember when I was in charge of BOIC in my first term, we would sometimes get complaints and you would always look into them. I mean, I think from the community budget folks, if we were dropping 18,000 people, we would certainly have heard about it from somebody other than the ombudsman.
We definitely hear it when there are anomalies. We definitely hear from the citizens. So my guess is that if there were 18,000, we would be flooded with many more complaints than what we have been.
Commissioner Saltzman.
So what is the current status of our ability to take text messages and respond?
So we worked with the Metropolitan, all at the Metropolitan Area 911 centers, and as a group, we went live with text to 911 late last summer, and we've been live ever since. We are taking text to 911 calls. We take approximately anywhere from 3 to 5 a day. We prepared and trained for quite a while beforehand, and we reached out to a lot of 911 centers across the country to find out what their experience was when they went live, and we're told that it was highly anticlimactic after all the training, and we found
3 to 5 a day, yeah.
And we found the same, and so we do staff text 911 on a 24/7 basis, so anybody that does text 911 is able to get through. Okay. We have processed a few calls on there.
So the other thing I was wondering about is, as fire commissioner, I listen to the fire channels on the radio a lot, and I notice that oftentimes, and it's not just 911 folks, it's oftentimes the firefighters too, but just plain old, and I think the word's enunciation, being able to understand what people are saying, especially when it gets garbled over the radios. Is that something that feedback is provided to a dispatcher if they're mumbling or garbling their words or stuff like that? Do they know that?
Definitely. Feedback is given to them. Anytime a complaint is received or a concern is received from our partner agencies, so from Police Bureau or Fire Bureau, we definitely feed that back to the dispatcher. We can have them listen to their transmissions and see actually how they're heard. More than garbled, we get a lot, or I shouldn't say a lot, but we do occasionally get a concern of speed talkers, folks that have a lot of information and want to get it out quickly.
Great, thanks.
Yeah.
And I just also wanted to thank Lisa Turley for your 15 years of service to our city. Thank you.
Thank you. It's been fun.
Yes, Frida.
Just a quick question, back to 311. If this program was funded and you had people trained for 311, would they require the same training as your 911s? And would 911's a very stressful job, so I'm sure the wages kind of go with some of that stress. It sounds like 311 wouldn't be quite a stressful job wage-wise, or are you looking at it being different?
That's certainly a question for other people, but yes, it does not require the level of training that the 911 operators have, and I would assume that they would be on a lower pay scale. But depending on where 311 is housed. I always fought for it to be at BOIC because I was the BOIC director, and I saw it as a career ladder kind of move, and that you could really bring people in with really good customer service skills and promote them up. Now that I'm a private citizen almost, I see that it could be housed at other places, maybe better, because it has a huge amount of analytics behind it. Talking about back of house, there will be a huge amount of analytics available to the various managers of the whole of every city bureau that is getting services from 311, and so you might want to have it more appropriately at the chief administrative officer level, or the mayor's office even. And so depending on where it's at, it would be the union structure might be different. So wages would be something that would have to be figured out as part of the process.
Thank you. Danishka, you had a?
That was my question.
Oh, that was your question as well. Okay, and I apologize. I did not pronounce your name very well the last time I called on you, so I apologize. Anybody else? Great, thank you. Wonderful presentation. Commissioner Fritz has.
Yeah, just one last thing. How long did your predecessors serve at BOIC?
The next longest person was 7 years as director. I've only been director 11 years, so. Oh, but I 11. Still, yeah. Wow.
Well, thank you again for your service. Thank you all for being here today. For those who are interested in continuing to follow our budget issues, we will next convene in a work session on Tuesday, March 21st at 9:30 in the morning, starting with the Portland Housing Bureau. Thank you all for being here today. We are adjourned.